gentlemen, the show is about to start in 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
He'll be fine on the mountain.
It's time for Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Built by the Barndominium Company, served by Chicken Cock Whiskey, and part of the Chief Sports Network.
Touchdown, Carolina! Touchdown, Ace Sanders! Pressure, and he just dives in!
And Jamie Bradford.
It is Big Gamecock Weekend. Greetings and good morning. We hope we're able to get you off on the right foot right here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show built by the Barndo Co. and always live from the Signarama Studios. Signarama.com. You will be all over campus this weekend and you'll see their work. There's a reason why they're the preferred sign partner of your South Carolina Gamecocks. Signarama, located in West Columbia, Gamecock owned, Gamecock operated by our friend and his team, Matt Vaughn, and I'm sure he'll be dancing around campus this weekend as well. We, of course, are served by Chicken Cock Bourbon. We hope you've got it at your tailgate. It's time to watch the Gamecocks play some football and some baseball beginning a little bit later on. Weather will impact the weekend, and we'll get to some of that here coming up in just a little while. We've got Stuart Lake at 11:20. We've got John Strickland at 1 o'clock, and we've got you covered for Big Gamecock Weekend. Sherbert will be here in a moment. Mad Dog and myself will lead you off, though. It's 11:05, and it is finally Friday. That is correct, Phil. What a weekend in the SEC for baseball as well. I mean, what a weekend. And it all gets started. Started last night, but A&M and Alabama were rained out, so they will throw the first pitch in 55 minutes in Tuscaloosa. It's back-to-back weekends where the Tide welcomed the number one team in the country to town. The last number one was last weekend, as I just mentioned, and that was the team that will come into Founders Park this weekend, Arkansas, who dropped 2 of 3 in Tuscaloosa. So them and the Gamecocks share the same fate on the home field of the Tide. Alabama, of course, is battling to be a regional host. With all that said, Phil, good morning, my man. Uh-oh, lost your volume there. Can't hear you. Did you catch your mic?
Look, I feel like Mike. Look at that. There we are.
There you go.
Let me push the buttons on my microphone. That's so fancy that I can hardly use it. No, welcome back to the Signarama Studios. Good to have you back, man.
Yeah sorry. I'm really sorry about that.
No, hey, listen, you know, life happens. That's the advantage of having three of us do this now.
Yes. Really five at the end of the day, but
exactly. That's as we've seen.
Had to get taken care of yesterday. Yeah. Oh, and we got him. Also, if you haven't, you can still do it. If you want to play golf Monday, the weather's clearing, so we're going to be able to play. So if you would head to the Big Spur, or if you want a direct link and you're watching our program or listening to our program, shoot Phil or I an email, which is available in the Chief Sports app in the Connect section, or comment right here in our chat box. We'll give you the direct link, and you can sign up to play. You'll be losing because Pat DeMarco's on my team, but you can sign up to play and have a good time. You can eat some great food from Nana's Porch, and you can participate in the silent auction and get to meet if any of you care to meet me. That's fine. But you can meet JC and you can meet John, and a bunch of folks will be out there. So really looking forward to playing at Fort Jackson with a shotgun start 9 o'clock on Monday morning, just continuing big Gamecock weekend. A couple of good questions in the chat box already. David asked, doubleheader tomorrow, rain Sunday. David, so we'll get an update on that after 5 o'clock today. After 5 p.m. today, we'll get an update as to whether they are going to attempt to shift the weekend around, which, by the way, might have something to do with the movement in the rotation that was announced yesterday by Coach Kingston, which we'll get to that here in just a little bit. We got Coach Lake coming up. So we'll know after 5 o'clock today. The weather's been playing some tricks. Matter of fact, I saw this morning from WIS in Columbia, was watching the weather forecast, and it actually looks like it might not really hit until mid-afternoon on Sunday. So they could play it and just move the start time up on Sunday morning if that holds that way. But safe than sorry, we'll play a doubleheader tomorrow, but neither the Razorbacks or the Gamecocks want to do that. They don't want to play 18 innings. And you've got the spring game tomorrow night, and certainly South Carolina doesn't want to have fans having to pick and choose going to the football game or going to the baseball game. It will affect attendance one way or another. But we'll get an update on that after 5 o'clock today. And then from there, we'll be able to make our plans accordingly to that. Hayne asks about my hat. This is a Letterman's Association hat, Hayne. These aren't for sale, but certainly appreciate you paying attention to it. Wanted to go with something different today. Got a haircut yesterday, Phil, so I had to make sure that that the hat fit the hairdo. So you don't know anything about that.
It's been a while since I've actually sat in a barber's chair. Just usually take care of the strays here with the razor.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. I'm debating on whether I want to wear this on Monday or not. I don't know. Harrison in the chat box here, one of our young bucks in our 15,000 to 20,000 a day crowd. Really appreciate you, Harrison, for tuning in always, and God bless you in your future. I think if I remember correctly, he said he's headed to South Carolina in the fall. Harrison said, not trying to be negative, but does anyone else have that feeling that there won't be nearly as big of a crowd tomorrow night in Willie B as there has been the last couple of years? No, I don't agree with that, Harrison. I think the Lenora Sellers factor alone is going to drive a bunch of folks into the game. It's another night kickoff, and I think that's something that's awesome. And folks just like to be in that ballpark, and we've all been in there for years and years and years and hundreds of times. It's home. You know, you walk into Williams Brice Stadium, and then you walk out in November, and you're like, I've got to wait 9 months to come back in here. So I think there will be plenty of people that will be there. I think Lenoris himself is going to be a driving force. You know, honestly, Phil, there really hasn't been like a ton to discuss in the preseason. I think a lot of us, everybody's, I mean, I've got some pretty good information, but it's nowhere near complete. It's 1% of probably what they've done. So right. I think we all, you know, are kind of anxious to get our eyes on it. I think there's going to be a pretty good crowd. They've done a nice job with Big Gamecock Weekend. This surrounds an incredible baseball series and other stuff that are going on. I'd say probably around 30,000 or so will probably be in there. That would be my guess. And that's a good crowd for a spring game.
Yeah, I'd say, yeah, I was going to put it at about 30 to 35. I doubt it'll get to 40. I don't know, though. I mean, you know, you got a lot of folks in town this weekend. So it should be a good size crowd. And, you know, I think that one of the things that helps with the spring game is that football obviously is the dominant sport, right, in any university. And you go through these stretches where you just don't get any. And then even a little taste of it is just enough. Like you said, it's like you go to Williams Brice. It's what we do, you know. So I think it'll be a great crowd out there. I don't think it'll look like some of those pictures that might have 100 to 200 or, you know, the ones that Beamer was talking about in his presser where it was like there was nothing but empty stadium. I think the dedicated are going to show up, and the ones that, you know, understand the whole recruiting aspect of having it be a live environment will also be there.
Yeah, I agree. There's going to be, and it would be great for folks to show up. It is a huge recruiting weekend, which we're going to get to all of that with JC in just a little while. He'll tee that up for us and let it go. Gamecock fan asked, are they doing activities in Gamecock Park? So here's the schedule. I've got it all for you. Big Gamecock weekend. There will be Friday night fireworks tonight after the baseball game. That's for sure. So if you are headed to Founders Park, make sure that you and your children stick around to watch the fireworks show, which I would imagine would be somewhere around 10 o'clock because first pitch is being thrown at 7. Tomorrow it's scheduled to be a 3 o'clock first pitch and then 1:30 on Sunday, but again, TBA on the weather. And so we'll see what's happening with that. As far as football goes, a couple of things to pass along here. Yes, Gamecock Village will be open at 2:30, and fans can pick up the poster. They are free and they will be available in Gamecock Village as well. Food will be available for purchase from multiple food trucks. Beer, seltzer, and water also will be available for sale throughout Gamecock Village. In addition, if you've got kids, and I do, and we avoided this last year, and I sure hope we can avoid it this year, multiple inflatables will be in the village to entertain those young bucks. The Palmetto Shirt Company will also be on site with a pop-up shop. The gates open to Williams Brice at 5:30. You don't have to pay. And the clear bag policy is in effect, and magnetometers are being used even for the spring game. Seating in the lower level bowl is open on a first come, first serve basis. Fans are encouraged to fill sections 1 through 9 first. The 200 level, the 600 level, the zone, and the 2001 club are open on an invitation only basis. The Cockaboose Club in the south end zone will be open with concessions, while the Horseshoe Club will be open, but concessions will not be available for purchase. The Traditions Club will be closed. Many of you may be running tomorrow in the Cocky Trot or the Fun Run. That begins at 8 a.m. Best of luck to all of you who do that. It's pretty neat. It starts in Gamecock Park. It passes through the outdoor and the indoor football practice fields, and then it heads to Williams Brice, and they finish on the 50-yard line. So if you've never been on the field and you're going to run, you're going to get a crack at seeing what it looks like from down there. And then on Sunday, the first ever Junior Gamecock Club movie night is at Williams Brice Stadium. Gates open at 5. They'll be showing Wonka that starts at 6. But there's weather in the forecast. There has been no update to that. So if you are registered for that and have kids that are planning to go, probably going to want to keep an eye on your email because they will correspond that way. Beach volleyball will be playing this weekend as part of the Gamecock Grand Slam. If you're going to head out there and check out Gamecock Beach Volleyball, they are beginning right now. And then again at 5:30 this afternoon. Saturday's matches are 11 a.m. and they are also at 5 p.m. Track and field, the USC Open is being ran tomorrow at the Sheila and Morris Krager Track Facility. Admission to the event, boys and girls, free, thanks to the University of South Carolina for doing that. So that's everything that's going on this weekend. There are tours of Williams-Brice Stadium as well. Maybe some of you have signed up for that. You can take pregame photos on the field and things like that as part of the Forever Garnet program that South Carolina has. And parking, by the way, also begins at 2:30 in Gamecock Park, 2:30. And it is free. It is free. So whenever you get in there, you can go up to the village and kind of hang around. There are additional opportunities to park, additional free parking in the Woodstock lot, which is behind the indoor facility, and on the Key Road lot, which is the university lot. The LMC Fair Park will open at 3 o'clock, and that is $10 per vehicle. South Carolina doesn't have control over that. So there you go. That's all the stuff for Big Gamecock weekend. So hat tip to the administration at the University of South Carolina for making this once again a lovely weekend for all families to be able to go and enjoy all this stuff on campus at South Carolina. The Heritage is underway. You might know somebody that there are low scores on the course. But we need to step aside. It's 11:17. When we return, the great Stuart Lake will be here. He'll be in the booth tonight and throughout the weekend calling the South Carolina baseball series with Arkansas. We'll preview that with the Hogs right here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
The State Farm Personal Price Plan helps you create an affordable price just for you.
Contact local agent Gary Patterson for your personal price plan today.
Touchdown Brewer. Set up a screen, and it goes to Brewer. 20, 15, 10, 5. Touchdown Brewer, his second of the day. Pitches it to Brewer. Turns the corner. Touchdown, number 3 of the afternoon.
Hey, folks, it's Mike Morgan for Ryan Brewer Fence. That's right. You know the former Gamecock legend as a terrific college football player. Well, I know him as that, too. I also know him as the guy that runs a great business, one of the best businesses in South Carolina. How do I know that? Well, for one, I'm actually a client of Ryan's. I had my home in Columbia done years ago, and his crew did an outstanding job, just as he does for everybody else. Whether you're in the market for a fence, railings, columns, or anything in between, their craftsmanship, their experience, and service second to none. Ryan Brewer Fence has over 15 years of experience with consultation and installation of residential and commercial fencing and railings. Rest assured, your job will be done with an unparalleled level of expertise, and it's done on time, and they do it right the first time. Again, you're not going to do any better than Ryan Brewer. Ryan Brewer Fence, the website is ryanbrewer.net. Set up an appointment today. Tell them Mike sent you.
My company is Billy G's Carolina Barbecue. We are based in Columbia, South Carolina. And we have two lines of sauces and a spice rub. I mean, when people try our product, they know it's a gourmet product and it can go on any type of food. It's not surprisingly delicious. It's expectedly delicious.
Oh, man. The building is on fire.
Emergencies and accidents happen. When you're in the middle of a fire or water event, all you want is for things to return to normal as soon as possible. Resto Pros of the Midlands is with you, guiding you through the process and working with you to get your home or office back in working order. They'll answer your questions, discuss procedures, and can act as your advocate when it comes to processing your insurance claim. RestoProsMidlandsSC.com. Open 24/7 when you need them. Quality that is guaranteed.
The State Farm Personal Price Plan helps you create an affordable price just for you.
Contact local agent Gary Patterson for your personal price plan today.
Yeah, man. Nothing like Eric Church to bring us back on a Friday morning as we get ready for South Carolina baseball. This is what it is all about. The Gamecocks welcome the Razorbacks to town this weekend. It is an incredible weekend, by the way, in the SEC. For the second consecutive weekend, I mentioned this at the top of the program, the Crimson Tide of Alabama have number one in town. That was Arkansas last week, and the Tide took two of three. from the Razorbacks. A&M is up next. They were washed out last night. They'll play at noon, and then they've got a couple more to go after that. And then you may have heard about this one. Fourth-ranked Tennessee is in Lexington to take on third-ranked Kentucky. First pitch thrown tonight at 6:30. But we've got our own problems here in Columbia, and hopefully those will be passed along to Arkansas starting around 7 o'clock tonight as the 20th-ranked Gamecocks and the second-ranked Hogs will tangle in Founders Park. And at 6:45, you can hear this guy who's become pretty brilliant on the air, Stuart Lake, the coach. And, man, it makes us happy every weekend to listen to you for 27 innings, sometimes more. But can't thank you enough for what you do for us and what you do for Carolina baseball.
No, I like – anytime you use the word brilliant, you got me right there. So, you know, excited. I know I've been listening to y'all this morning. Be interested in what the weather's going to kind of determine this weekend to shape into. Man, yeah. It's going to be some fun baseball with Arkansas.
Yeah, it is. Tonight, so they're going to start Kimball tonight, and I know what King said yesterday. I also kind of get the sense that part of that decision had to do with maybe if they have to play 18 innings tomorrow, having a guy that can give you, you know, 5, 6, or 7 innings instead of a guy that gives you 2 or 3. What do you think about that?
Well, it is. You know, I've kind of listened this week, too, because I was caught a little bit off guard because you heard me on here so much. Eli Jones is thinking at the tone for the pitching staff, just like we talked about Cole Messina. And I think Cole did that since going in that leadoff role. But I think when you start to look at what you're matching with Arkansas and then the weather becomes an issue, you said it a few minutes ago, nobody wants to play a doubleheader. And really don't want to do a doubleheader with our spring. But it'll be interesting to see how that shakes out. They got to determine it before the game. I heard you say like 5 o'clock. They get the latest 6 o'clock. They have to determine it with the SEC prior to the game. That way nobody can use it for their benefit. And it'll be interesting to see how it keeps shaping out.
Yeah, the weather kind of keeps shifting around. But it's this morning, WIS has it coming in around 3 o'clock on Sunday, Coach. So maybe they will stick to the plan and then just move up the Sunday start, 11 a.m., 12 o'clock. I don't know. But I do know this. Hagen Smith is going to have the ball tonight for Arkansas, and he's good. He is really good. And he's going to come in tonight looking to kind of continue what he – has done throughout the season, and it'll be Roman Kimball on the other side of that. But the junior lefty is 7-0 with a 1.53 earned run average, 47 innings, 17 walks, 89 strikeouts in 47 innings. But it takes me back just a year. This kid's a lefty. That kid was a righty. Paul Skeens walked in. He was the hottest arm in the nation. Yep. And the Gamecocks belted him out of the ballpark. Now, it's going to be a little different tonight coming from the other side, but hopefully the same outcome.
Yeah. Now, remember Skeens about 8 out of 9 outs he got last year, too, to get the home run from Wimmer. So, I mean, this is a different type pitcher. You just said a 1.53. That's his ERA overall. Rarely does it go down. He's less than that in SEC. He's a 1.21, a 1.20 ERA guy. In SEC play, you just don't normally see it go that way because obviously the level of competition. But he's a fun guy to watch this tonight. We got to see last year fans to get to see Hagen Smith this year because his name will get called early on the day of the draft of what he brings. And but the big thing of this Arkansas team, and you really don't start looking at them besides watching them on TV play them, I didn't realize they were hitting 238 in the league until like – that week, because I started watching them again. I was at Citadel, so on trade they're 7-0. I'm going. They come back and win 9-8, and they win the next day. But this is not an offensive team like Arkansas has had in the past. In the past, Arkansas, you felt lucky if you could hold them to that 6 or 7 runs of their offense, and then they had good pitching. This is more of a good pitching and defensive team who just has kind of average hitting. So it'll be interesting to see how that matches up with our pitching. I think our pitching could really show that these guys' numbers are true. I think we're going to have a good weekend pitching against them.
Well, I sure hope you're right. I mean, they also are the only team in the league with an ERA in league play under 3. at 2.96. The only other team with a ERA in league play under four is Kentucky. They'll walk into the ballpark next week. So the Gamecocks are going to have their hands full in the next six SEC games. We'll get to Kimball in a minute, obviously, but I have only seen a little bit of Hagen Smith this year, Coach. I haven't seen much of him. I think I watched him pitch one game on TV on a Friday night. Of course, I've seen him prior to this. What do you know about what makes him so dangerous, and how does South Carolina attack that?
First of all, about him, everything that I kind of watch and see, too, is, you know, he just really controls the game. You don't see a guy that works really quick. Not crazy quick like A&M was trying to do us or holding us. It's just a guy that's going to be very professional in his rhythm to the game. And it's just going to be all he throws. He can throw all his strikes when he needs to, but he's got upper end velocity, obviously, that you're going to see. How do I attack? I was joking around this week when we were in Charleston. It's almost one of the things is just go ahead and say, look, we know we're going to strike out 10, 12 times. And I say this jokingly, but really you sometimes have to say this to you. Hey, we're going to strike out 10 or 12 times. Let's just get over ourselves. Let's not get all emotional when we strike out. Let's not get all body languagey when we get called out. Here's what we can't do. When we get a runner in scoring position, we can't strike out then. We've got to find a way to put it in play, whether it just be a ground ball, whether it be a base hit, because you're not going to get a ton of runner in scoring position opportunities against him. So when you do get them and you're 0 for 2 with 2 Ks, it don't matter. You're at the plate now. So really for this offense this weekend, you're going to be in the now, because if you're going back thinking what you've done against him, maybe a bad or a punch out, that's when Hagen Smith rolls it up on you. You're all of a sudden over three, whatever. But I like what we did last week. We're going to have to get the left-handed pitcher, so you're not going to steal a ton. But we've got to be ready for any ball in the dirt. He does throw. He's going to give you some opportunities. And your catchers do a great job of covering, recovery of it as well. But I think we're going to have first third inside on a base hit. We can't be trying to be station to station on it, because it's going to be really hard to get multiple hits in a row because his stuff's just not good. It won't be because you aren't good. His stuff's just good.
Yeah, and sometimes you just have to tip your cap. I was texting with Whittle last weekend and in Gainesville, and I said, John, this really isn't that hard, although it is hard. It's hard to hit in the SEC. We know that. But if they would just change collectively – if they could adjust their approach when they're ahead in the count, 0-0, 1-0, 2-0, 3-1, to just try to drive the baseball back up the middle, that's going to bring the gaps into play. It's going to take the ball out of the yard. Like, quit trying to do too much. Hit the ball back up the middle. At least let that be your focus. And then when you've got two strikes, battle. You know, battle. You and I have talked about this before. Johnny Cribb used to always say, don't get beat. Don't let him beat you. And just keep fighting. The more pitches they throw, the more opportunities you're going to get a mistake. The more the guy on deck sees, the more the dugout sees, the less amount of time he's going to be able to stay in the game. They did that largely for three games last week, and I don't think I'm some prophet. That's just baseball. I mean, you're the coach, you know. But it seemed like they had made some adjustments, and it worked out largely throughout the weekend to be able to get a series win down there. And against a team like this, like, you can't walk up to the plate and just expect that you're just going to just tee it up and let it fly. Not against this staff. I mean, we're talking about Hagen Smith, but there's the entire staff, their whole ERA, the whole team is under three, so they can all pitch. So hopefully that approach maintains itself.
Yeah. And you got to understand too, if you're going to, and you're going to have strikeouts tonight, I've told y'all before, you're going to have about 6, 7 strikeouts. One of the top-end guys. So you're kind of going in my mind, I'm going, look, we're going to strike out 11 times tonight. But in those 10 or 11 times, they need to be at least 5 to 7 pitches pitch to strike us out. You can't just have 3-pitch punch outs. If we're going to get in their bullpen in the 6th inning, we're going to have to make him earn his strikeouts, file a couple balls off. Maybe it's a 9-pitch strikeout. Maybe it's a nine pitch hit. Let's make him work hard, because walking in that center field here at Founders Park is still hard for a visiting team to do in this league. And we should have a really, really good crowd here. We're not playing them in Fayetteville. And you got to remind them early on of that. And I hope our crowd does that. I've been there. You know, we were there for Super Regionals. It's almost impossible to win there because the umpires get caught up in it too. Umpires love getting patted on the back. How do they get patted on the back? The crowd cheering. They love it when the crowd is cheering for them and they're getting a call strike three and they're getting to bang a guy out. Well, you get to do it at home. So you got to make Arkansas play tonight. It can't turn into a, you know, we're just going to go up there and feebly try to have at bats. I love these games. These are the games that used to get me more excited than, to be honest, it's harder for Arkansas tonight. They don't know what Roman Kimball's going to bring them tonight. They're looking at the same stat sheet I am, and they're going, hang on. So the guy that's starting tonight for them has 8 innings pitched in league play. He didn't pitch on 2 weekends healthy in league play. So if I'm the hitting guy, I'm sitting in my hotel going, okay, what am I missing? And that's where they're at. The great thing about us, we ain't saying none of that. We know what Hagen Smith's got. And as a guy that played in this league, you play in this league for a couple reasons. The environment's incredible. You get treated like you're in AA, AAA baseball. But the real reason you play in this league is you want to pitch and you want to hit against the very best. And as a hitter tonight, this dude right now might be the best right now in the league. So it's a tremendous challenge. And you get to do it at home against a team that's 3-3 on the road.
Stuart Lake, it is 11:35. It is Friday. It is game day for South Carolina baseball. Spring game, of course, tomorrow night. As part of Big Gamecock Weekend, Carolina, with this 3-game series with the Razorbacks. All right, so let's get Kimball into the mix here. He has looked better in his last few outings. And it was never the stuff. It was just being able to throw strikes. Can you command the strike zone or not? And that was kind of his problem for a while. But it looks like he has recaptured some of that. It's hard to not think, and I don't mean this disrespectful at all to Roman Kimball. I hope that Roman Kimball throws 90 pitches in 9 innings tonight and we skate out of here with like a 5-6-0 win. But it's hard to imagine that there's not a plan early, maybe with a Ty Good or a Matthew Becker or something like that, depending on what the matchups look like and the analytics are saying, almost like a predetermined split, not saying that it will be that, but almost that you're kind of approaching it like that, coach. But give me your synopsis on Roman and what you've seen out of him the last couple of weeks.
Well, I've seen a guy, and this happens to all of us, that got humbled a little bit and realized that I said it to y'all. He was kind of like the kid that didn't want to clean his room when they put him in relief. He would kind of come out the box, which was very good. And I think it took a little bit. Hey, we're going to move on without you, or we would really love to have you. It's your choice. And I feel like he's made the decision now. The last few times out of bullpen, he's been really effective. But he's also come in, and he's been that same Roman Kimball that I was expecting the whole time, just that kind of always fixing his shirt and looking like he's ready to go, and he stays right around the rubber. He don't leave the dirt. It looked like that guy the last few times out. And this is what Roman Kimball enjoys. I mean, this is an environment tonight that he's getting to pitch on Friday night against Hagen Smith at a packed house. This is where I think he is going to excel. How will he match up against the Arkansas hitters? I'm not sure yet, because I don't know if his breaking ball is going to be landing for strikes. I don't know the umpire's strike zone. We can say what we want. The umpire is part of the game because his strike zone will determine the strike zone. So if he's giving Roman a little up or a little out, this isn't a great hitting Arkansas team, but if he's making him throw it over about 15 inches of the plate, then they're going to get some swings off, because this is a good Arkansas team. They're just not the Arkansas team we remember offensively. So that'll be the key to see which guy allows what the umpire allows Roman to be.
Yeah, coach. And Arkansas doesn't strike out much. I mean, they've struck out 250 times, I think, or something like that throughout the year. I don't have their SEC stats pulled up, but they do put the ball in play, which is good news right now. Carolina has played well defensively in the SEC. Would you agree with that?
I agree. Yeah. Now, this Arkansas team comes in fielding. I think there's a second or third team in the league in fielding, so they do play great defense. The reason they play great defense is their guys pitch so well, they throw a ton of strikes for them. And you play great defense when your pitchers work quick. So that's a big thing. If we can stretch out our bats tonight, it puts a little more pressure on them defensively. But you watch their games, and their games are typically 2 hours and 15-minute games because their guys pitch so well that, and they don't have a huge offense this year. Their games are relatively quick when you watch them.
Yeah. Yeah, they move right along. Two-hour baseball games. Who'd have thunk it?
Just all like right. The MLB wants it, right? I mean, that's
yeah.
Let's get in, get out, and go home.
Well, you know, they could. The games could be faster if they call more strikes, but I don't know what umpires
they're
trying to do anymore in baseball. All right. So I sent you a text last week because I hadn't really paid much attention, and I got the lineup, and I said, Cole Messina in the leadoff spot.
Yeah.
All right. But it worked. He was, what was he on base? 13 times in three games down in Gainesville? 12?
Yeah, I think it was either 12 or 13, but it was just it was just right out of the gate, you're facing a dude. You know, that's a knock on anybody else, but I mean, he just came to the plate and the game starts. He hit the double off Caglione the other day on Sunday. And even though Florida ended up winning that game, Jack Caglione, he hadn't given up a hit in his first three innings of like a SEC start this year. And you got a guy at the plate that could handle his fastball. Dude was 98 miles an hour, hit a double. And just immediately they went, uh-oh, we're going to have to score today, you know, which they got fortunate enough to do it. But, you know, he's just a dude that enjoys that. As I said, Eli Jones loved setting that tone for the pitching staff. That's what Cole loves doing so much for the offense.
Yeah, that was a great point. You made that point, I think, in the pregame show with the other guy. What's the other guy's name? Derek?
Yeah.
Scott? Yeah, okay. Yeah. He didn't add much to the broadcast, but don't tell him I said that. It was an interesting move, and it worked. I know Cole had a tough night in Charleston the other night. I felt like he was trying to do a lot, you know, being home. And
yeah, they were doing the moose cheers for him. It's hard to come, quote, back home. And obviously, Riley Park is home. I think he may have tried a little – too hard to, and it happens to the very best of us.
Hat tip, by the way, for getting Smoke to commit to wanting to sit on the radio for an inning, B, for getting him in an inning that lasted a while. I was texting him. I said, yeah, you were hoping this was going to be about a 7-minute inning, weren't you? You've been up there for 20 minutes. But it was a great, that was a neat conversation with Smokey. He's a brilliant baseball mind. I got a kind of off topic here, ask you about Jack Caglione. I mean, we watched him play for 3 years. He's gotten better every year. You've seen every kid known to man in the game of college baseball. How do you describe him?
Well, the closest player I've coached to him is Stephen Head. I coached him at Ole Miss. He was a two-way guy, first baseman, left-handed pitcher for us. He was our closer. But he threw 91, 92. And you know, you knew his chance, and he went on to pro baseball as a hitter. But this is how I described Jack Caglione to my buddies. He looked like the dad that took his kid to the Little League game, and the other team didn't have enough guys, so he played. That's an incredible compliment to anyone in this league to physically look that dominant. I don't remember, y'all. I'm trying to remember a guy that looked that dominant in the league, not playing FAU, not playing whoever. I'm talking about within the league. I watched the Vanderbilt game last night. He's now hit 8 home runs, you know, 8 games in a row with home runs. And I showed my wife, and she said, my God, how big is he? Because she had not really paid attention last weekend. It looks like he wears like a size 18 shoe when he gets in the batter's box. I can't imagine that he's not within the first 8 to 10 names called out on the first day of the draft. And the cool thing for me is I get to watch these guys, and I've got to watch this league, and you'll see, does the guy have good makeup, or does he just look like a turd? There's guys that are in this league I just didn't even want to be around. And the dude hung around after a loss and signed stuff for Florida fans. Mm-hmm. He gets the fact that to those young Florida fans, he's a big deal. And I just noticed when the game ended, Sully went off, you know, the way he does, pouting. And then I watched Jack Caglione, who should be the kid. You know, he's 19, 20, whatever years old. The dude's over there signing stuff for kids. And that just showed me something. I mean, that showed you this is a dude. If I'm there as a scout, I'm staying back to see how he acts. I watch him with his teammates. He does everything they do. Watch, if you watch a game with him again, look how intently he looks at his coach for signs. That's a big deal to me, because most guys that are this good are looking at you like, you know, come on, you weren't as good a player as me. What do you know? I've had those guys. He is looking intently, and if I'm a teammate of his, I realize I have to do the same. And I don't know if this Florida team is going to be able to get it going. I really don't. I watched Vanderbilt kind of put it on them last night, 10-5, and I think they're going to scuffle to find their way in. But it won't be because of Jack Caglione. Derek kept picking on me. Would you pitch to him here? And I don't know if y'all heard me. I said, Derek, I don't know how to be more clear. I would never pitch to the guy.
Yeah.
Is that good? I would never pitch to this guy in a game that does anything. And he's hitting balls. We got very lucky. Think of them two-line drives we caught in that Saturday game. I mean, the umpire at second base was nervous because he almost got hit twice by balls that were 112 and 114. And he's standing inside the base. So he was 125 feet away, because I saw him after the game and he goes, dude, I wanted to move into the outfield. So I just, you'll learn, y'all learn me. If I don't like you, I don't say much about you. I might
he's
not
kind of like
about you. I just won't say much about you. I don't know if I can say enough about what I saw with Jack Caglione. I think the dude's a special dude.
Well, I do too. I want to make a couple of a quick comment to follow that up and support what you're saying. I was watching the game last night as well, and Chris Burke. By the way, Chris Burke is ESPN should be paying him a boatload of money. He is just flat out brilliant on television. I'm a huge Chris Burke fan. Huge Chris Burke fan.
And Chris Burke is who Jack Caglione reminded me of personality-wise. Chris Burke used to come over to your dugout after a series and fist bump the coaches. Chris Burke has been Chris Burke as a player. I mean, that's when you say his name, that's how Jack Caglione came off from a distance last week to me. The dude understands his role, just like Chris Burke did at Tennessee back then. And Chris Burke had a head coach that was weird too. So he had to deal with it back in the Tennessee days. I think that's a great name to put together with a Jack Caglione.
Well, and he that is, if you're compared to Chris Burke, you're gonna be fine. Chris Burke said something on the broadcast about this kid last night that there's always we all know the game within the game. If you're kind of a baseball guy or girl. There's always the game within the game. But then, as you pointed out a minute ago, scouts, and there's always stuff that they're watching that the general public, the general population, the general fan has no idea that matters. And Berkey said last night on the broadcast, when they got off the bus, Cags was carrying the bat bag. And, you know, he made the point, which clearly we know, like, dude, junior stars don't carry the equipment around. Junior stars get off the bus and go get to work. And, you know, if you're the freshman, you're flipping coins and drawing straws for who gets the equipment and stuff like that. And this kid gets off. And of course, Berkey said, he said he's so big, you know, it looked like he was carrying a, you know, a paper trash bag around basically. But, you know, he asked him why do you carry the bat bag? You know, you don't have to do that. And he said, Caglione looked at him and said, I don't know. I've always done it. Like, so that's just another example. Like, that might not sound like much to somebody, but it is, right? It's a huge deal. I can tell you right now, Justin Smoke wasn't carrying the bat bag. Hell no, he was not even as a freshman. He was never carrying the bat bag. But Jack Caglione just picks it up and goes. So I don't want to spend the whole show on Cags, but I was really interested to get your perspective after calling those three games down there and watching him play. All right. Elsewhere in the lineup, hat tip to Will Tippett. You know, he has just been struggling like anybody I can really remember who's an everydayer in the lineup. And then he goes down to Gainesville last weekend, and he got a couple up and out of there. I don't know if it was the breeze or if it was the 95, 96 off the arm. I don't know, but they got out, and then he drilled one the other night at the Joe downtown. So give us an idea of where you think he is now.
All right, I'll tell you how it went in a week. So Will gets to be our player of the game last weekend. So I text Billy Anderson the way I do, because it takes me forever to get through crowds and get down. I go, hey, Will Tippett's our player of the game. Can you keep him close? Yes. I get down, and Will Tippett is over talking to his parents. So I go to Billy Anderson. I go, hey, did you tell him he's player of the game? He goes, yeah. So I walk over to Will, and I go, Will. And I'm holding a microphone. I'm getting nervous because I know Derek's out there giving me the oh, we're about to go. I said, hey, you're player of the game. And he goes, I am. And I said, yeah. Did Billy not tell you? Yeah, I thought he was joking. I said, we don't joke about that. So as he walks around the net, he's walking with me, says to me again, he goes, am I really player of the game? I said, and I stopped. And I said it very serious because I really thought he deserved to hear this. I said, Will, I need you to understand that in this league, the good players handle adversity. That's what makes them really good players. Everybody's a front runner. Everybody loves to be the guy to pat you on the back when you just went 2-for-4. I'm patting you on your back to tell you I've been watching you when you went 0-for-4. And I've loved the way you've handled it. This is me giving you a compliment tonight. So I don't joke about these things. And he looked at me very serious, and we did our stuff. So Citadel game, he's my player of the game again. So I text Billy, you know where Tippett's at when I come down the other night? Standing right by the door. And when I come in, he fist bumped me. He goes, I'm starting to get used to this. I said, good, you deserve it. You just made 3 defensive plays tonight that changed this game. The double play that you and Parker, they're leading the league in double plays. Y'all hear me talk about that all the time.
Yeah.
Think of a football team that's leading the SEC in turnovers. They're usually pretty good. Double plays are turnovers. They change innings. They change momentum. They're huge. And when you can do that, it does it. And then he looked at me and he goes, I hit a home run too. I said, oh, I know you did, but you ain't the player of the game tonight because of the home run. You're player of the game tonight for me because of what you just did defensively. And he just smiled and came on and we did our talk. But the kid, you know, that's why I got Smokey on there. I hate switch hitters that are naturally right-handed. I don't even know why you would ever want to be a switch hitter if you're naturally right-handed. And when Monty told me what they were doing, and I said, I thought he was left-handed here. He goes, no, he's right. He should have been. Why is he switch hitting? And Monty laughed at me because he said, oh, here you go. Because Coach Tan, same way. If you hit right-handed, you've grown up your whole life with right-handed kids throwing to you. So you're used to it. If you're left-handed, you've grown up your whole life with mostly right-handed kids throwing to you. Then all of a sudden you get to a higher level and they start throwing left-handed and you get beat by curveballs. That's why kids switch hit. Right. When you're a right-handed hitter, I don't want you to switch hit. What is Justin Smoke? A natural right-handed hitter. That's why I wanted him in the booth the other night. Mm-hmm. But he ain't really, because what did Justin Smoke do throwing? He threw left-handed. Right. And he told me, he goes, I was probably a natural left-handed hitter. My dad just wanted me to hit right-handed till I was like 12. And then he finally said, hey, try it. And he hit a home run. And he said, even I struggled to at least my junior year to hit left-handed. And right, he said, so I think Will Tippett's going to be a guy that is a part of his offense moving on.
Well, it's great points on Smokey too. I remember those days well. And with Tippett, because he's had the issues and you feel like he's regaining some confidence, I really hope, and I would anticipate this. I don't think this will change. Look, Will, your job is to be the best 9-hole hitter in the league. That's your job. Get us back to 1-2. Flip that lineup over. You know, because we've talked about this before too, and you see this happen all the time. It's hard for coaches to make these decisions. You got a guy at the top of the lineup or something that's been scuffling for a while. Dude in the 7-hole. Dude in the 8-hole. You know, similar hitters. Guy in the 8-hole swinging it well. You bump him to lead off, and now you've compounded the problem. Now you got a problem in the 8-hole and in the leadoff spot instead of just having an issue up top. If he continues to swing it well, I hope that that's something that he can own. I'm the shortstop and I'm the 9-hole hitter, and I'm going to get you back to the top of the lineup. From a comfortability standpoint, not only just for him and for the lineup, I think that would be a tremendous asset moving forward.
I think so too. And I agree with you. You know, you learn from who you learn from. I learned from Coach Tanner. We knew the lineup almost every day unless there was an injury and a player change. Mm-hmm. I love the fact when guys don't have to look at the lineup to know where they're hitting. You know, I know I hit behind JC. I get used to hitting behind JC. All of a sudden, I'm hitting in front of JC. It screws me up. That's how baseball works.
You'll never hit behind JC.
Well, you never know. I might need him up there. He's a contact guy.
That's what I'm saying. Six home runs for the Dodgers, man.
Yeah. JC's got hidden skills. I know that. You guys, I keep scouting reports on everybody. In case a softball game breaks out, I got him in there. But my point is I hope our lineup now starts to settle in. I love Cole in that role because he has kind of screwed everybody up as an opponent. Like, holy, we got to deal with Messina first. You know, I love Parker Nolan second. Y'all hear me say this all the time because if somebody's on first, it gives him a bigger hole to hit a ground ball through or left-handed hitter get a base hit. He blocks the runner from the catcher. I love that. Ethan Petrie's obviously a three-hole hitter. I mean, that dude's got to hit in the first inning. He can hit with nobody on two outs and make your whole inning change because he can hit the ball out of ballpark anywhere in America. And then you're starting to file in who you want fourth. I know that's changed a little bit lately. All of a sudden, this guy's hitting fourth. You know, I hope Kennedy Jones. To me, I'd love to see Kennedy Jones hitting fourth. Because if I'm a pitching coach and I've got to decide to pitch to Ethan Petcher or not, Kennedy Jones looks like he's 25 years old. I look over on deck and that dude's standing there. He looks like a minor league player already with his body and his maturity. I just start now what I hope we see in this last 5 weeks is just I'd love to see that where I just write the lineup without Kent giving it to me, you know, unless obviously somebody gets banged up that, you know, you don't know. Cause I think guys are falling into those roles and Will Tippett, man, you can do things at the bottom of the order. You can flip the lineup over for us. When he gets on base, he can really run. Mm-hmm. You know, he and Brewer on base, you don't even really want a bunt. You want a fake bunt. And we did it the other night. We showed a fake bunt and stole. That's big time stuff. And that's how tonight, if you're going to have a chance to beat Hagen Smith, you're going to have to do those kind of things. You ain't going to be able to just sack bunt and give up another out. Dude, I'm telling you, you're going to strike out 10 times a night.
Yeah.
So nobody needs a boo or put on Twitter. We strike out all the time. You're going to strike out 10 times a night. Move forward. That means we got 17 outs that we got to beat Arkansas with tonight. And if you go into it that way, you're not going to get so upset when you strike out. Because it's going to happen. This guy's that good. If you're striking out 6 or 7 times against average SEC starters, then you know you're going to probably strike out 10 times a night. No big deal. If you strike out 13 times a night, it's still not that big a deal if you take advantage of the ones that you get.
Have quality at bats. Got to have quality at bats. Looking forward to seeing Dalton Reeves back in the lineup too. I'll be interested to see, not just because it's Arkansas this weekend, but this kid has really come. You talk about quality at bats. To me, it's not the balls that he's hitting or getting on base with or hitting out of the yard. It's the ones that he's not. I mean, every at bat that he steps up there, he's got a plan. It adjusts with the count, and he does something that helps the team every single time. With all that said, it's the world of analytics. Dalton Reeves does have holes in his swing, just like everybody, and the SEC will exploit those the more that he plays. So how does he adjust moving forward? Will certainly be a key. Final quick one here. And it's a big picture item. The whole baseball world is still in front of the Gamecocks here, Coach. If the season ended today, they're hosting a regional. There's no way you'd be able to keep them out with that RPI, where they are in the SEC. 9 quad one wins on the year. It's the third most in the nation coming into the weekend. And now you've got these back-to-back opportunities right there in your home ballpark. I mentioned earlier this week, it seats 8,200. So I would expect and hope over the next 6 games, because there is no midweek, that there's 48,000 people to walk through the doors to watch these guys play, because they're right in the thick of this entire thing here. So the SEC, as I would say today, the SEC is probably going to get 6 hosts, and they're playing for 7. Kind of give us a quick synopsis on what the league has shown you and where the Gamecocks stand in that.
Yeah. Well, the East is playing so well this year. You jump over to the SEC West and you get caught off guard by some of their records because Ole Miss, Mississippi State, they're all still kind of hovering around, but they're not as gaudy as Arkansas is 12-3. So you start looking, I think this could be the year now to get that 7 host. If you can keep yourself, you got 15 games left. You went 8-7. If you go 8-7 again, man, you put yourself into what you really you want to fight for first is make a regional. If you take care of business, that should be done. Then you want to fight for hosting a regional. If you can take care of business here in the next few weeks, that can be done. Then you want to start fighting to be one of those national eight seeds. And to do that, you got a lot of work to do that with the Tennessees, the Arkansas's. All these teams are going to be vying for those eight seeds, but you'll see at least two SEC teams in it, maybe three this year in those eight seeds. So I said it, y'all, last week. I say it again. Everything is available for you. If you take care of business this week and can get – if you could get a series win this weekend, it would be ginormous. Kentucky's going to get beat up this weekend. They got Tennessee and Kentucky. Tennessee's really good. Tennessee's going to knock some of that confidence off of them before they get in here next week as well. And remember, we're going to exams next week, so no midweek game. So you get to really get after it this weekend, whatever scenario with the weather, and then you don't play again until next Friday. So you better rest mm-hmm. back up. Oh, you're pitching ready to go. So, man, everything – I'm hoping every Friday in the next 5 weeks we're talking more host possibilities, really see if you can creep your way into that national top eight. Clemson's banged up.
Yep.
I'm on them national eight seeds right now, but, you know, they done lost some big guys here for the rest of the way. It's hard to replace some of the guys they're losing. So their team, you start kind of – Coach Tanner used to call it, we're all vultures. You start looking – all those teams you're trying to get and see what's wrong with them and pick at them. But first of all, you got to take care of them.
Take care of Arkansas. That's for sure. Do you have something real quick, JC?
No, no, I'll get to that in a second. We got a little chat box issue here with Tippett. And I'll just remind everybody, none of these people are on scholarship here. They pay money to go play for your team. So, no, you don't need to rip a kid on Twitter in baseball. Rip the coach all you want. He's making money. But, no, you don't have the right, John Edward, to do that. Kid's trying as hard as he can. So,
well,
I'm with Stuart. I think just like last year, Will Tippett is going to have an impact in a positive manner on a game from the plate before the season's over, maybe two or three.
Well, here's tell y'all about Will Tippett and a lot of guys, but we're talking about Will. He cares. I just described Jack Caglione. Why does Jack Caglione carry that bag down? Because he cares what his teammates think. That's why he cares that.
Yeah.
Will Tippett cares. Will Tippett is a guy that I got – I'm on his side in this one because I can – I've watched him. I don't know him. We don't hang out. He cares. And the way Gamecock baseball has always been is if you can get enough guys that care, you're usually pretty good. And I know he's one that does. There are a lot of them that do, but depending on him in that regard. Just made some plays the other night. There ain't many people.
This team's won 26 of 37 games and hadn't played its best game yet. So I'm pretty fired up and excited about it myself. So.
Yeah. Yeah. And the final nugget I'll add on Tippett. And again, I'm with you, coach. I know what it's like to struggle in this game, as we all do. If you've played it, it is a hard game to play, and it's and you're gonna have some rough days, but you can look back on this past week and give credit to Will Tippett for winning two games for you, helping you win the series in Florida and beating the Citadel and sparing you from coming home with some egg on your face. That Citadel team's gone through a lot this year with injuries like the Gamecocks have had the last couple of years. They've about run out of players. And they still almost beat South Carolina the other night if it wasn't for three Tippett plays and a Tippett home run. So it was Tippett's week. Hat tip to him.
Yep.
No pun intended.
I'm just excited, like Jay said. We got everybody in town. Exciting week for Gamecock baseball for me.
Amen.
Hey, man. Can't wait. I know I'll get to see you this weekend, so I'm excited for that. Yep. My kids are excited, and my wife's excited to spend time in Founders Park in Williams Brice Stadium.
Don't just do hot dogs.
we're getting Billy G's barbecue, man.
Yeah, barbecue. Yeah.
Billy G's barbecue. Really appreciate all you do. Can't wait for 6:45 airtime tonight. Stuart Lake, Derek Scott, game one, Arkansas, South Carolina at Founders Park. Go get you some good lunch, my man. And I'll holler at you a little bit later on.
Perfect. Thank you. I enjoy it.
Thank you. You're the best. And Coach Lake is the best. Really, really, really good stuff. All right. We got plenty of football. John Strickland will be here today. to preview the spring game, but we'll get into some of that coming up in hour number two. Carolina basketball could be on the verge of some major, major signings. We've got some of that as well and much, much more. We sure hope you'll spend the next couple of hours with us as we kick off big Gamecock weekend right here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
We have started in 1979. Because we're a manufacturer, we're able to control our costs. That's why we like to manufacture as much of the product as we can, because in our factory stores, we can offer a competitive edge over other people around the country. When people come into one of our Palm Casuals, it's like they're buying their car at Detroit. They're going right to the factory and buying their car.
30-day money-back guarantee. That's a big deal with us. I mean, we give 30 days to do anything. I mean, return it, change it, get a different color, get your money back.
When you pull into a store and it says Palm Casual, you know you're at a factory store.
Rescues and Resin, proud supporters of Carolina Rise. They are also proud partners of the show. They make products you can't get anywhere else. Custom designed wood and resin products that make your tailgate, make your home, or make anything stand out. Order a custom cutting board, coasters, wall art, tables, and more. Contact Dustin and Tabitha at rescuesandresin.com today. Rescuesandresin.com, and put your imagination to work. Rescues and Resin, proud partners of Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
Hey, Gamecock fans, Mike Morgan here. During my time in Columbia, one of my favorite places to eat was Salsarita's. When I go back now for work or any other reason, it's still Salsarita's. Yeah, I'm like you. I love tacos. I love Tex-Mex. Where are you going to go to get them? Well, you've got two convenient Salsarita's locations, one in Lexington at the Target Center and one in West Columbia as well. Now, if you like tailgating, and who doesn't? Whether it's for a football game or anything else, they've got the catering hotline. Get yourself some Fiesta packs to take tailgating. Get yourself the Three Amigos bundles for tailgating. They make catering easy with a fresh, hot setup. And again, you just call the phone number 803-543-6297 to set it up. You can also look them up online, or you can even download the app. Salsarita's is just a cut above the rest. That's why they're serving Williams Brice Stadium and the South Stands, also serving in the Colonial Life Arenas. Again, that catering hotline number, make it easy for you and the folks out there. You don't need to settle for sandwiches every time. 803-543-6297. 803-543-6297.
It's 2024, and it's time to get in shape. Charleston Fitness Equipment can help you do just that in Mount Pleasant. The Wilkins family, big Gamecock fans and proud supporters of Carolina Rise and our programming on the Chief Sports Network. But most importantly, proud supporters of you getting healthy and staying healthy. CharlestonFitnessEquipment.com. Find them on the Chief Sports app and in Mount Pleasant. Happy New Year.
Billy G's Carolina Barbecue serves you at Founders Park, and they serve us here, providing the national anthem at noon every day. On Inside the Gamecocks, the show, Billy G's CarolinaBarbecue.com to order catering, CarolinaBarbecueSauce.com. If you suck as a cook or a chef and you need to literally fix everything, you like, do your vegetables, are they too tough? You don't have any flavor. You bought the stuff that's been frozen, then it's in the store, and then you cook it up. You put too much oil in it. Now it's too oily, and what are you going to do? Well, you just sprinkle the secret spice. Bam. Oh, man, this is great. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And Mr. Bill doesn't care. Take all the credit in the world. It's not his fault that you suck as a chef. That's what he's there for. And they'll deliver that stuff right to your doorstep. And then, of course, now, if you're going to do ribs, you do maybe some chicken. Yeah, the sweet heat. That's what you want to do. And then you got the Carolina Gold to make your barbecue at home. And if you can't do any of that, or maybe you don't want to do any of that, and you're going to be in the vicinity of Founders Park, you'll find them deep down the right field line, but in foul territory. And then they'll be back behind home plate as well. And if you're headed to any of the three ball games or all three of the ball games this weekend, we hope that you will eat there, try the Big Tex or the Big Porker, or pretty much everything on the menu. The smoked mac and cheese is special. Billy G's Carolina Barbecue presenting our national anthem here on ITG.
All right, let me explain the difference between criticism and bashing and facts and emotions and your feelings and your facts. First of all, F your feelings, okay? Anything based on your feelings are your responsibility to control. And that it's soft not to control them. That's number one. Okay. So let's just get that out of the open. It's one thing to say, like, look, Will Tippett's struggling at the plate. Will Tippett needs to get better. Will Tippett this, that, and the other. Those are facts. Nobody's disputing that. It's a sports talk show. If you put it on Twitter, that's fine. Saying he sucks, saying he needs to be benched, saying, oh my God, here he comes, predicting doom and gloom every time he gets to the plate. That's negativity. And here's what's soft about that, John Edward, is that you don't have the self-control. You're not man enough to control your emotions to where you want to attack a kid that's not on scholarship, that's trying his best, because you think your opinion matters that much in a public forum. It's not about being criticized. It's not about sitting there with your buddies going, man, he sucks. That's one thing. But you put it out there in public to embarrass. The only purpose that serves is to embarrass an 18-year-old kid that pays to play for your freaking team that you profess love. I mean, that's soft. You want to know what soft is? That's soft, okay? Because you're not man enough to sit there and control yourself. You know, you're not realistic enough about who you are in this world to understand that you're doing damage by putting it out there in public, even though you are, as everybody's pointed out, a complete nobody. So you want to get into the societal debate with me? I'll win it every time. That's soft. We're not talking about going woke here. We're not talking about not hurting anybody's feelings. We're talking about the reality of the situation with this young man and the fact that adults, people that claim to be adults, claim to be men, like you are, because you know the soft thing, everybody's so soft, can't control their emotions and want to sit there and put damaging information out about him because of your sports team. That sucks. I've seen you defend Duke basketball players in here. My God. You know, and you're going to sit here and say that it's your entitled right to sit there and bash Will Tippett on Twitter? That's the stupidest thing I've ever heard. Get out of my – don't listen to our show anymore if you're going to continue to do that. I mean, I know you're a good listener and all that. Don't do it. Cancel everything with me if that's going to be good, because that's soft. That's sickening. That's sociopathic behavior, all right? And I don't stand for that. It's one thing to be a fan. It's one thing to be critical. It's one thing to sit here and talk about it amongst us, even in the chat box. Hey, you know, this guy's really struggling. He's not that good, whatever. I don't know why he's playing. Question the coach, whatever. But to sit there and think that it's your right to put something like that out on Twitter about an 18-year-old kid that's paying to play for your team, that sucks. That's soft, because that means you just can't control yourself. It's scary, quite frankly. I think you need help.
I don't think I need to say anything.
Oh, yeah, that was a good silence there. It was like, you're just going to let that marinate for just a bit.
I don't That was pretty good, JC. Not too bad. I think we recorded the program, don't we?
I'm in a good mood today, man. I mean, by the way, I know I've kind of been grumpy a couple of episodes the last few days. I'm in a great mood today. I'm going to my first ball game since I'm going to Founders Park for the first time since 2015. When me and Woodrow went to see him play Penn State on a cold night, I sat in the press box. So I'm in the stands at Founders for the first time in a while. I get to go to the spring game tomorrow, get to catch up with my boy Jan and at the tailgate tomorrow and see his beer tree. I'm going to the bourbon bash tonight. I'm happy. I'm fine. But you're not going to sit here and, like, bash poor Will Tippett or any of these guys. And it's not really okay for scholarship players either, but football and basketball players get it and all that. You know, and a lot of them are making NIL money. So I don't like it because they're still college kids, but I get it. But you get to sit there and it's not facts that you're not putting – you know, he said, well, this is facts. It's not facts when you put it on Twitter like that. You're putting a public record out that's disparaging someone for no reason just because you think it's your right. And then we do have freedom of speech, and that's fine, but that doesn't mean you're in the right to do it. And it has nothing to do with manliness or being soft. In fact, it's just the opposite. It's pretty soft and weak to pick on an 18-year-old kid on Twitter and believe that it's your right to do so.
I don't disagree with any of that. I think that was perfectly well said. I have always found that it is it's embarrassing that people attack people on social media, and a lot of those people will walk by these folks in public and never have the guts to say something to their face. And in addition to that, not just the kids, but their families. Like, I could only imagine as a dad, if my kids are playing college athletics and there's some twerp on social media going off on one of my kids that knows nothing about them, knows nothing about their story, how hard they work every day, what they've put into their entire lives to get to this point. They put that uniform, they run out there, they do their very best and the whole nine yards. And then there's somebody that's probably literally never done anything in their entire lives athletically, like outside of probably some video games and maybe getting cut from your 9 or 10 year old t-ball team. They've never done anything. And then they think that because I have a right to an opinion that I need to share it. And I have Twitter to protect me because nobody can really actually find me through this app. And I've always found that pretty disgusting, not just at South Carolina, but all across the world. And it's made it easy for people to be cowards. And so I agree with you. The kids, you know, they're kind of immune to it now, but they do see it. And you know, if you can be better than that, be better than that.
It's embarrassing to Gamecock fans that you call yourself a Gamecock if you do that. I don't think we need you. I mean, nobody needs you. Nobody needs you at all if you're going to do stuff like that. And unfortunately, there's probably only like 20 or 30 of them, but you're talking about 20 or 30 on Twitter and then only like 100 are active tweeters. And so, you know, you have thousands of Gamecock fans that browse it and don't tweet, you know, just like the message boards. 80% of the paying members of thebigspur.com never post. So I just can't get behind it. It makes me sick to my stomach. And did you try to throw the reverse man card thing at me about it? I'm far from soft. I think it's soft what you're doing. That's soft. That's going – you're like the beta male in Texas Chainsaw Massacre that like told Leatherface he was going to cancel him and held up his cell phone to tweet something, and Leatherface cut him in half.
Yeah.
That's who you are in this situation. And so that's it just makes me sick. And I don't know you personally, John Edward, and I've never really had a problem with you. I have a problem with what you're saying, not you personally. I have a problem with what you're saying. And if that's who you are as a person, you know, then maybe you need to kind of, you know, do some reflection and see if it's really worth that, you know. So that's it. All that's up, I'm done with it. Let's be happy.
Yeah. Well, and I'll add this too. John Edward, you can downplay that he hit a home run against the Citadel, but had he not hit a home run against the Citadel,
I mean, it was only the winning run. It's only the game. Right?
And then what would you be saying as a fan? Not only that, he also hit a home run on the road against Florida last week. Again, he's almost the sole reason that they won two games last week, that they, of the three that they won. And I mean, I just, it is, you go try to hit against the Citadel. If you think they're that bad, grab a bat, step up to the plate, see what happens. Because you can't hit them. You probably couldn't hit somebody in a T-ball game right now with the ball on the tee. So that's enough. That's enough. That's enough. If you don't like the players that you watch, if you think they suck, don't watch them.
And I hope you enjoy the new Taylor Swift double album that was released last night.
I mean,
I'm just kidding. That was a low blow.
Like, I it's not personal. It's just, you know, when I see, just to kind of support what you're saying there, you know, and we're not going to let this show go in this direction, but I'm just saying I need to see more improvement from Well, who are you? What do you mean you need to see? Are you the coach? Are you Mark Kingston? Are you? Tell us. If you're Mark Kingston, let us know right now so we know who we're talking to here. Well, because if not, then you don't need to see anything. The guy who needs to see it is the dude who writes the lineup. He's continued to put him in the lineup, and it paid off this past week.
And, so, and look, it's one thing to say that, like, okay, well, I don't know that he's arrived yet because of one good game. That's a sports conversation everybody has. It's quite another thing to say, oh, it's so soft that we can't bash him on Twitter because you're not prepared to admit that he had a good series and a good game. That's psychopathic. That's sociopathic. That's mentally ill. There's a difference. You're not saying what you're saying now. You weren't saying that earlier. You were like, it's murder. So whatever, man.
Yeah, I mean, who's to say this past weekend and that midweek wasn't him, you know, climbing on the trajectory of what I'm sure he also feels. That's the other side of this. You think Will Tippett doesn't want to do better? You know, why is he out there trying?
Happy
he doesn't want to do better. You know? I mean, that's the thing that kills me. It was
To the coaching staff's credit, you know, making him a non-switch hitter seems to have the coaching staff too but look, the coaching staff makes money. They're pros. They're up to whatever you want to say. Criticize them all you want as long as you don't attack them personally and say something stupid. But to their credit, everybody gripes about them. I mean, the moving Messina to the one worked. That's not something none of us here, even our baseball guys, would have thought about. And, you know, I think the Tippett switch hitter thing was something Whittle and Jamie both had mentioned, but, you know, I give them credit. You know, they're trying. Everybody's trying. They're 26-11, folks. They have a good next couple of weekends. They're in the hunt to win the SEC. So I fail to see the angst and consternation so far, other than nobody likes to watch a lot of strikeouts, yours truly included. But that's baseball these days, you know. So,
well, here's my challenge to all of you that will be watching Gamecock baseball, especially if you're going to go out there in person. Join the Will Tippett fan club. Stand up and give the kid an ovation when he walks to the plate. You know, change the narrative. You know, get up there and cheer for this kid, because he's they have to have Will Tippett to win games. He's the shortstop. Yeah. And if you've got, like they do, pretty good guys up there at the top of the lineup, you absolutely have got to have somebody at the bottom of the lineup that can get you right back to it. This team cannot win without Will Tippett. They can't do it.
And who's it? Lee Ellis? Is Lee Ellis his backup? Is that who the backup is? Yeah. Lee, yeah. He's not quite ready. And he's going to be a good player here, I think. But he's just not quite ready. So if you lose Tippett, you're going to rock and roll. So, so let's switch it. Yeah, so people are talking about – We got a lot to talk about. You know, we'll probably – I'll tell Whittle to pass on to him that we spent a lot of time talking about him today. He probably likes to – I think that's the most we've discussed Will Tippett on this show. So, it's going to be a good weekend. It should be a weekend everybody's kind of looking forward to, with Arkansas in town. It'll be a big weekend next weekend with Kentucky. I mean, it seems like every week the Gamecocks play a top three team, but – that's how you build the resume to host a super regional and all that. And we'll see if the coaching staff can hit the trifecta, because you got the Messina move, you got the Tippett move, and now Roman Kimball is the Friday night starter. So let's see if the Midas touch continues tonight in what will be, in my opinion, and it's unfortunate because I like offensive baseball like everybody else, I think I'm about to go to a pitcher's duel. One of those, like the North Carolina game the other week, which can be fun and intense, but I have a feeling it'll be like that.
Yeah, to your point, then we'll step aside and hit a timeout, and we'll shift gears to Gamecock football this weekend with the spring game in town. I've got a feeling Roman Kimball is going to look pretty good on the mound tonight. And, you know, again, I like kind of setting up the rotation. Your Friday night guy is your Friday night guy. But they've had a Friday night guy this year, and then they've kind of had a revolving door behind that for a multitude of reasons, which we don't need to go through all of that at this point in time. But all of these guys are good. Matthew Becker and Ty Good and Dylan Eskew and Roman Kimball and so on and so forth. They all can start on the weekends, and of course they have. And going into this weekend to win this series for a multitude of reasons, again, the potential of a doubleheader tomorrow certainly came into play when they had this conversation. But moving Eli to Saturday and giving Roman the ball tonight, they're not going to give the ball to somebody they don't have confidence in. That's not what's going to happen here. It seems to me like he's ready. And so they're going to give him the ball on Friday night. They thought when he transferred in from Notre Dame, he'd be getting the ball on Friday night. So lo and behold, he's going to have it tonight against the second-ranked Arkansas Razorbacks. So we'll touch on this again a little bit later on, but I would expound with you, JC. I'm glad you said it. It's an old-school term in the game of baseball, pitcher's duel, and we might have one tonight with Hagen Smith and Roman Kimball from Founders Park. All right, when we return, we've got Carolina football, the spring game tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. John Strickland will join us at 1 o'clock today to look deeper into this as well. A lot of stuff to kind of hit on from a lot of different angles at Williams Brice Stadium. We're powered by Electric Bikes of Charleston. I ended up being able to get out and cut some grass yesterday, and I was reminded that I need to get back into grass cutting shape with summer right around the corner here in the great state of South Carolina. It was warm. And if you want to get outside and cruise around, and you can do it by going to Electric Bikes of Charleston. They're located in the Low Country, but they sell to everybody. There's people that come from everywhere. There's a reason for that. Their service is the best. Their warranties are guarantees, the whole nine yards. And most importantly, one of the loveliest people on the planet, Michelle Wilkins and her family own it. And they are huge, huge, huge Gamecock fans. And we cannot thank them enough. Also, big contributors to NIL. So if you're going to do business, if you need an electric bike, maybe you live somewhere else, please give these guys a crack first. Give your Gamecocks a chance. They deserve it. That's why they're the best. ElectricBikesCharleston.com. Spring game up next here on ITG.
Chicken cock originated in Kentucky, like so many other bourbons. And so the resurrection of it, you know, Paris, Kentucky, that's the county seat of Bourbon County. So much of this whiskey was being made in that Bourbon County, put on ships and barges and shipped down Ohio, down the Mississippi, and got to New Orleans, where it got distributed all over the world. And people kept saying, well, hey, I want some more of that whiskey from Bourbon County. And so that's how bourbon whiskey got its name. And Chicken Cock originated actually in Paris, Kentucky, which is today Bourbon County.
Welcome to Palm Casual Patio Furniture. Because we are the factory, Palm Casual has the ability to offer the highest quality outdoor furniture paired with world-class service. Since 1979, our factory showrooms have done our best to make the buying process as easy as possible for our customers. Our understanding of the many factors that go into your decision has helped us create our 30-day trial period that increases the level of comfort our customers feel during the shopping experience. Visit us in Somerville, Mount Pleasant, Myrtle Beach, in Bluffton, and online at palmcasual.com for our products and out-of-state locations. Gamecock owned and operated.
Building your dream home is often just that, a dream, and sometimes a nightmare. But at the Barndo Company, they commit to quality and build without sacrifice. Customization, open floor plans, limitless flooring options, maintenance-free and easy insulation perks, and affordability are just a few reasons why they've been named one of the best builders in the U.S. Believe in your dreams. Visit thebarndominiumco.com. That's thebarndominiumco.com. The Barndo Company. Gamecock owned. Gamecock operated. The preferred sign partner of Gamecock Athletics is Signarama Columbia, and they should be yours too. A full-service sign company that handles design, production, install, and service, Signarama Columbia has helped to bring to life the perfect vision for so many all across South Carolina. Owned and operated by proud Gamecock alumni, they can handle all types of signage, including interior and exterior, vehicle graphics, and more. Go to Signarama.com and find the West Columbia location or call them at 803-407-9284. Bring your brand to life with Signarama Columbia, and go Gamecocks.
Hey Gamecock fans, this is Roman Kimball with South Carolina Baseball. My friends over at Electric Bikes of Charleston have the largest selection of e-bikes in South Carolina. You can cruise up to high speeds of 28 miles per hour, which is about 70 miles an hour slower than my fastball. Stay in shape and enjoy your life with an electric bike from Electric Bikes of Charleston, where buyers come from all across South Carolina. Visit electricbikescharleston.com. See you at the ballpark, and go Gamecocks.
Gamecock weekend. Welcome back inside the Gamecocks, the show. Palm Casual will keep you comfortable on the back porch while you're watching your Gamecocks play. PalmCasual.com, located in Bluffton, located in the Dirty Myrtle, and in Somerville, and in Mount Pleasant. Palm Casual, owned by, well, I don't want to say his name, but we'll just call him Wheezy. Wheezy. Big-time Gamecock fan, bigger than all of you. Doesn't go...
Is his wife's name George? Is he moving on up?
No.
Is that a neighbor named Willis?
No.
Neighbor named Bentley? Bentley?
If you, what is it? I-Y-K-Y-K? If you know, you know.
If you know, you know. He's great people.
Playing on my team on Monday. Playing with Pat and I. And hopefully Michael. But Michael and I are in a fight right now, so I don't know if I'm going to even let him play on Monday. I'm going to kill him before I let him play golf, but that's okay. That's for another day. PalmCasual.com, it's the best of the best. The 30-day guarantee is something you can't get anywhere else. They hand you a check. Bam. Oh, man, I'm sorry it didn't work out. You want to pick out something else? No, we'll come back and look down the road. We understand. Here's your check. We hope that doesn't happen. Rarely does. But the guarantee is there. PalmCasual.com. All right, JC. So, all right. So he just, before we get there, speaking of Carolina football, can I say this? You just told us this during the break. Can I say what you said or no?
Yeah, that's fine. I don't think it's the text, or whatever. It depends on which one of those private texts us that you profanity, man.
Yeah, no. Some of them we know are not for air.
You gotta put it out.
Okay. Because I think this is neat because we love Meredith. The Heritage is playing today. She's not there because she has to work. But Meredith Taylor, McKellar Enterprises, as y'all well know, is the host of our guest lines here. That John Strickland will be on just a little while. And we just had Coach Lake on. Her business where you can like her, the McKellar Online Academy, you can go online and literally learn to play golf through her website, sign up with lessons. You can do virtual lessons with Meredith if you're a golfer. So Taylor Edwards, the director of personnel for Gamecock football, is now a client of Meredith's. And as many many, many people are. That's why it's hard to get a hold of her these days. But so if you have, like, clearly Taylor, and we know Taylor, so he probably walked out. He watched Shane whacking around. And man, this Beamer guy can play a little golf. I need to get better. So he, you know, he's got to get with Meredith, and now he'll probably try to go out there and challenge Shane. And I'm trying to think of who the better golfers on that staff are. I don't know. I would venture guess that Beamer would beat all of them. But so if you need golf lessons, or if you need help with your golf game, Meredith Taylor, man, if y'all have seen her on our show, there's nobody on the planet that is sweeter than her, but also nobody that probably knows this game better. At least it's in our lives. And we're really proud of her. So we hope
it's not like the Spurs staff, man. You had because they all had to play with him. And so they all had to be good. Like Junior, imagine being Steve Spurrier Jr. on the golf course. Oh man. So he was good. G.A. Mangus was really good at golf. When Beamer was here, he was good. Most of those guys, he'd drag them all out there. Come on, guys, let's go. We got a tee time, fellas.
If for some reason Flint ends up not being able to play on Monday, I might text GA and have him come play with us.
Oh, God. Yeah. You should tell him to come on anyway, man. That guy, anytime you see GA is a good thing. I could
Flint and just put GA in there.
Michael's in the doghouse right now. So. But yeah, it's good. But I also want to on the Big Spur golf tournament. Still room left if you guys want to sign up and play. Go to the Big Spur. We're going to be out there. I'm not playing. I'm going to be broadcasting and watching everyone play, and probably having a cold one or two, eating some barbecue. But it'll be a big time. It's for charity. So be sure to go check that out. Also, want to thank one of our sponsors here, Resto Pro of the Midlands, jumped in with an event sponsorship that significantly contributes to the bottom line for the charity and the money we're trying to raise and all that good stuff. It's going to be out at Fort Jackson. Shotgun start at 9 a.m. And it includes a barbecue meal for $100. And we're going to have some raffles and I think silent auction. There's some really good stuff. The G.G. Jackson rookie card for the silent auction. That's something because I donated that one, right? I had questions as to whether or not it would be valuable. I think it's pretty valuable and signed. It's got his autograph on it now too. So that is a skyrocketing item that you can come invest in out at the event. And we have some other stuff too, signed memorabilia, stuff like that. So if you got time, please come on out. We'd love to meet you guys in person. It's the Vicksburg Golf Tournament on Monday. And we're going to have a blast. And thankfully the rain is going to be Sunday most likely and not on Monday.
Yeah. I had it and I don't know where it went, but, I don't know where it went. I had a list of all the silent auction stuff. There's some good stuff in there, but I don't know what I did with it. Yeah. Anyways. All right. Pertaining to the game this weekend, JC, and we'll talk a lot about the game with John coming up here in just a little bit, but it is a huge weekend as far as prospects getting on campus. Give us the latest there.
Yeah, we just Hale just released a list. It's a pretty loaded group as far as a lot of different positions go. Receiver Brian Rowe, of course, who's committed to the Gamecocks from Concord, North Carolina, just got a Georgia offer this past week, so it'd be good to get him back on. Jaden Sellers is committed, of course. Jordan Young from Monroe, North Carolina. And then Malik Clark from Rock Hill, who kind of keeps visiting. There's a crystal ball out there for him for North Carolina. I don't know, man. I think the Gamecocks maybe he was trending in that direction. So we'll see. Mike Tyler, the tight end from here in Columbia, from Hammond, I would put him on commit watch. The other one, Hayden Bradley from Buford, Georgia, is another guy. Sean Elliott's targeted. This group of offensive linemen is impressive. Juan Gaston from Lilburn, I think he's a mid-4-star guy. He's got offers from everybody in the country. Shedrick Surratt from Gaffney, I think he's a little bit underrated. High 3-star guy, lean to the Gamecocks. Tennessee's kind of lurking around him, Virginia Tech. Kid all the way from Louisville, Kentucky, Isaac Soles Jr., offensive lineman, will be in. He's interesting. Gamecocks don't normally recruit Louisville. Lonnie Teasley's gotten him. He's an interior guy from Male High School. They got a great tradition up there for high school football. So he'll be on campus. Gamecocks don't always do well with Kentucky kids. They've been second on a few. A lot of those guys end up staying home, but we'll see how it goes there. And then an offensive lineman from Savannah, Georgia, who Auburn is predicted to get as of now, Jacoby Ward. He's a big road. He's from Benedictine, which we all know pretty well. But Auburn's got a crystal ball in for him. But he is 6'4", 335. That's what we call a road grader, folks. A road grader. Defensive side, Anthony Addison, who's committed to the Gamecocks, committed last week. A four-star edge who's really, really good from Thompson High School in Alabaster, Alabama. It's a big-time program over there. Jared Smith, 6'6 and a half, 235. The number three edge prospect in the country per 24/7 Sports Composite.
Wow.
It's hard to get kids out of Alabama, folks. But he named the top five the other day, all out-of-state schools. Georgia, Carolina, Tennessee, Southern Cam.
Is he originally from Alabama? Or
I have not done that much research on it. So I don't know, but I know, like, one of my friends, actually, his kids go to Thompson High School. That's a big suburb of Birmingham. And sometimes those kids from that school don't go to Bama or Auburn. But it's interesting that he's coming in for the spring game. And I think that, you know, when you do look at the coaching staff right now, because there's new guys and there's the way they recruit's a lot different than it used to be, where you could, you know, one, like your running backs coach would go out and sign 11 guys at different positions. It doesn't happen that way anymore. I think one thing we can say is Sterling Lucas is good at winning recruiting battles against the odds. I mean, he got Dylan Stewart, and he was right there with Nick Harbor as well, along with some other guys like Desmond Umiazulu. So that's a good sign there if you're kind of looking for a player at a position of need. Not as big as it was last year, but still. I mean, you know, 6'7", 240, dude. I mean, come on. Mm-hmm. Bryce Davis, the defensive lineman from Greensboro, North Carolina. He's crystal ball to Georgia right now, 6'3", 245. I guess projected on the interior at 245 right now. Probably what they're looking at is he's in Georgia's system, which is a multiple front, and Carolina's is too now. Probably a big end, kind of like what they're doing with Elijah Davis and what Georgia does with Tyrion Ingram Dawkins, if you want a point of reference there. Heck, shoot your shot. Who knows? I know he's got a lot of different offers. Caleb Williams is a player from Virginia, Chesterfield, Matatoka High School. When Shane was at Virginia Tech, he did very well in Chesterfield. It's near Richmond. A lot of Hokies came from there when he was there. He's a four-star guy for 24/7 Sports, 6'6", 250. Projected interior, could be a big end. Hale actually thinks this guy, if he told me, like, he comes back for the spring game. I don't know if Hale said commit watch, but it sounded like he was thinking about putting in a crystal ball for the Gamecocks. So, and I think this, man, I'll just share something with you guys, because sometimes I get discouraged too. you know, I can't really get discouraged on the air sometimes, but during the period where Carolina just had one commit, I start seeing all these Virginia kids commit to, like, Penn State and LSU or wherever, you know, wherever the kids from Virginia went. And I started thinking, man, you know, the Gamecocks, they should slowly but surely start getting, you know, Ari Wofford went to Clemson. They should slowly but surely start getting in to Virginia. It's not that far away and all this other stuff. And then, sure enough, all these Virginia kids pop up. So maybe I should get discouraged. Virginia is a gold mine, because Virginia and Virginia Tech are not up right now. So Caleb Williams is at Kevin Wynn, for all of those that worry about the defensive tackle position, four-star D-tackle from Greene County in Greensboro, Georgia, 6'2", 320, fire plug. It's the Gamecocks, Florida State, and then Georgia's got him in for an official visit. he would be a zero technique for Georgia. But we all know Georgia signed 155,000 defensive tackles last year. Five-star Zayden Walker from Schley County, Jalewis Solomon's brother. Jalewis put on Twitter today, too, that he would be there. Man, just keep plugging away. It ain't going to be easy, but you're right there in the game.
Hale, you weren't with us on Tuesday. Hale said he likes where Carolina is in this Zayden Walker deal.
I do, too, right now. And, boy, you think about this in a 4-3 alignment down the road, or three linebacker alignment, Zayden Walker, Wendell Gregory, and Freddie J.R. Johnson. That's a – that'd be on paper – potentially OPP. I'm going to start calling that OPP, on paper potentially. You down with OPP? But, no, on paper potentially, that'd be the best linebacker core they've had in some time. I mean,
can I ask you a question real quick on the linebacker recruiting? How much? And I know from what I understand, Walker's lead recruiter is Clayton White. They're signing linebackers both in the portal and out of high school. And I was just curious. Clayton White takes some heat, of course, as a defensive coordinator, but as a recruiter, if he's either leading the charge or involved in the recruitment of the reformation of this linebacker room, isn't it maybe time to give him a little bit of a pat on the back? Because this room's come a long way in 2 years.
Sure. There's no question about it. And, you know, I don't know that he necessarily took any I don't see where, you know, the guys that get in trouble are guys that take chances on players, and then, you know, they'll sign five defensive backs and four of them will just bolt. You know, because they're not that good, and then some of them end up not playing football ever again. You know, Clayton didn't land the big timers, but he didn't necessarily take anybody that was a head scratcher. Pup Howard and Stone Blunt were not head scratchers. Bam Martin Scott. The thing with him was a lot of big time schools like Auburn and some others wanted him to go to JUCO an extra year so they had room for him, and he came to Carolina early. You know, Debo Williams has certainly turned out to be a pretty good player. I mean, he inherited everybody else. So I don't know that – and there's been guys he's lost, don't get me wrong, especially up in North Carolina. And I think the territory part of it is probably where people are like, you know, he's recruiting North Carolina and they're not getting guys out of there. Well, nobody is in South Carolina right now. But, yeah, man, you pile Zayden Walker on to the two guys they got now, and then what they did in the portal, getting players and, you know, getting Bam Martin Scott better and getting Debo better. You know, that's why I always kind of said the whole, well, you got to hire a linebackers coach kind of thing was, you know, as time went on and I kind of looked at the reality of the situation, I don't think that was necessary. You know, I think it's been pretty solid. It's been a function of personnel and injuries and things like that. I mean, 2 years ago, in 2022, if Mo Cabba doesn't go down injured, I don't think anybody's complaining about linebackers at all. But you had to throw Sherrod Green out there, who was not ready to get back to be 100 to be who he was. Probably just wasn't the same. And yeah, you're gonna struggle a little bit. So that's the deal there. DeMarcus Leach, who is the first long lengthy safety in the boat for the Gamecocks this year, as they look to replace people like Nick Emanuore down the road. He's going to be there. I love this kid, Shamari Earls, from Chester, Virginia. Chester Field is Caleb Williams. Chester, Virginia is Shamari Earls. I put in a crystal ball for him this week, cornerback. And, man, that's a great – isn't that a great cornerback name, Shamari Earls?
Shamari Earls.
That's a great corner name, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, so five predictions in, 100% South Carolina. He is the number 118 overall prospect in America. Mid 94.55 on the composite. That's almost a 95. Number 15 corner in the country. Number 4 overall prospect in the state of Virginia. 6'2", 180. Man. And top 3 is Duke, South Carolina, and Virginia. How about that?
Interesting.
Probably, yeah. I'd venture to say the Doty and maybe the Honors College here. Maybe the Honors College, don't quote me on that, has a little bit to do with it. But, yeah, he's something else. Jonte Gilbert, who we've been talking about for a long, long time, Ohio State commit and then decommitted and looked like he was going to commit to Carolina. Then crystal balls pop up for Clemson. Tigers are still in it, although he doesn't have an official visit scheduled for them. South Carolina, Tennessee, UCF. UCF is May 31st. The Vols are the 14th. The Gamecocks are the 7th. So he's going to be back on campus. I like the Gamecocks to make another charge here. I think the Clemson thing's maybe come and gone. A kid that I have kind of on commitment watch in the back of my pocket is AJ Brand, the athlete from Irmo High School. They like him as a safety, kind of like another guy like a DQ Smith. So the Gamecocks are right there with him. They offered him very early. Kendall Daniels is on commit watch. He's from Norfolk, Virginia. Long, lean, safety type. And then another DB that's in for 2020. These are all 2025. I'm not going to go over the 2020. Another corner is Jaden Shipps from Archbishop Spaulding in Severn, Maryland. I guess they like it. They have him coming in as well. Three-star guy, Maryland, NC State, Boston College. A lot of ACC offers for him. Does not have an official setup for South Carolina. Has three ACC visits set up. That said, because he's a corner, I would still keep an eye on this guy. Just don't toss him yet. Tennessee's offered. That's an SEC offer right there. But keep an eye and see if things maybe progress a little bit. Because he could be one of those late riser types that a lot of schools end up being after.
35 as of now is the number. 35 prospects will be in town, including or from both the 25 and 26 classes. The number that I doesn't always equate to talent necessarily, but I think in this case, the large majority of it does. 13 of those 35 from the Palmetto State. And that's been something that's been very important around here for a long time. JC, as you've well noted over the years, being able to recruit your own backyard. A lot of these are blue collar kids, much like they've got on the field right now. JC, as you, if you don't recruit the blue collar kids and take care of your state, it is much more difficult down the road. Correct me where I'm wrong, to be able to sign the big names, the big guys. And you're not going to sign them all every year. But it's harder to sign those guys if you're not signing the other dudes in South Carolina.
Yeah, no doubt. I mean, and you look at this 2026 class, folks. You have Desmond Green, Big Des, 6'4", 325 from Timberland.
St. Stephen.
Yep, first Timberland kid since Quentin Washington.
And yeah, Alger, quite Alger a St. Stephen.
I think, yeah. Art, my boy Art that played at Carolina, he's not the coach there anymore. Anthony Baxter from South Point's another big offensive lineman for that class. Jamel House is a tight end from Newberry High School, 6'4", 207. Keep in mind, this is 2026, so you're like, oh, why are you taking a 207-pound tight end? Because he's going to be 240 in 2 years.
He's like 15.
He's a growing boy.
Yeah, we're talking about AJ Brand. Well,
he probably added 10 pounds on in this during this show. Right, yeah.
How about these two receivers from right here in Columbia? Donovan Murph, 16. Is this 2026? I said I wasn't going to talk about it, but I am. Already offers from Prime. I'm just going to call them Prime from now on, since that's what they want to talk about all the time, not Colorado. Alabama, Georgia Tech, NC State, North Carolina, Oklahoma, Penn State, South Carolina, Tennessee, Virginia Tech from Irmo. From right here in the metro. And then at Ridgeview in the Northeast, just go across clockwise, you got Jordan Gidron, Georgia, Illinois, Alabama, Auburn. I mean, this 2026, 6'2", 185, Duke, Florida State, NC State, North Carolina, Oklahoma, Ole Miss, South Carolina, Tennessee. No offer from the Tigers, the other Tigers. So, but everybody else has offered this guy. So, and look, I'll be honest, this early, you do have a lot of verbal offers. And, you know, once kids start visiting, you kind of get a better picture of like who exactly has offers on the table. But certainly to get that many offers early, I mean, it's shaping up. I mean, oh, I forgot Jazavian Currents, who has been on the, he's actually ranked. He's been on the radar for a while. 6'3", 194-pound corner from South Point. He's going to be on campus, too. Right now, the number one player in the state. We'll see what happens. Florida State, Arkansas, Florida, South Carolina, you name it, they've offered. So this 2026 class, fellas and ladies, is shaping up to be a just right now, just because there's so many knowns at the moment. So, you know, there's some unknowns. It's shaping up to be pretty salty within our state. In fact, I've kind of been, you know, waiting for a class like this for a while. The last one that would look like this early, it was unfortunate because you had the kid, I think the kid from Hartsville that went to Clemson, and the kid from T.O. Hanna, Stephon Wynn, that went to Bama, both went to IMG. Mm-hmm. And Xavier Thomas went to IMG. So, you know, people kind of got out of Dodge, and so the class ended up not looking that great. But if everybody can avoid the IMG thing and do that, I mean, I think this could be a renaissance of a class as far as, you know, high school recruiting in the state of South Carolina. And that's always going to be good for the Gamecocks.
Yeah. One name you didn't mention, my favorite name on the board for the Gamecocks in the 2026 class from the home of one Henry Hank Aaron, Mobile, Alabama, linebacker Shadarius Tootle. Shadarius Tootle.
Tootle.
T-O-O-D-L-E. He'll be in town this weekend. He's a 6'3", 210-pound linebacker in the 26 class that's been recruited by essentially everybody in the SEC, A&M.
Yeah. Shadarius Tootle. Christian.
We got to get to an early break here to make sure that we get caught up. So we got a minute left here, JC, but I don't think had a chance to talk to you about this earlier in the week. Quick thought on running of the spring game. Clearly, big Gamecock weekend. You know, they work on this collectively inside of the athletics department to try to combine it with something. Arkansas coming in is a great weekend to do that for Gamecock baseball. It'll probably help attendance everywhere. I understand that. Also, though, from a football standpoint, trying to get in, and we'll talk to Shane after the spring, so maybe we'll get into his brain on this a little bit. But have you learned anything about that? The timing of this? There's not a lot of spring games being played this weekend. It's the last one. Also, this past Monday, the transfer portal officially opened, which means transfers can be in town, and you've got a lot more access. The timing is a little bit interesting when it comes to being able to entertain prospects from the portal. And then also having guys that you're not competing with other spring contests around the league.
Yeah, I think it was interesting, the timing. And I don't know why exactly they did that. It may have been because there's some new coaches that came in and he wanted to push it back. Usually he kind of followed the Muschamp schedule where you would do a couple of springs and then go spring break and then come back. But it was all after spring break. I think in this year when you're trying to kind of rebuild some momentum, there's something that it's good that you're the only trip on the books this weekend, because then you can get some of these guys, especially for 2026, because you know you're gonna, this is where they start forming their opinions. So you go out, it's a night, it's one of the few night spring games that are out there. It's the lights and all that at Williams Brice certainly are very attractive to kids. And with a night game too, you get all day to kind of hang with the coaches, you know what I'm saying? And so there's more time to build a relationship. So I think strategically in recruiting, it worked out well. Did I crawl inside of Shane Beamer and George Wynn and those that make these decisions, did I crawl inside their head and know that's exactly why they did it? No. But certainly it is a welcome development for this point when you talk about Gamecocks as a football program and their recruiting momentum moving forward.
We will hit a timeout. We have also learned over the last 18 hours that Arizona State transfer quarterback Jaden Rashada, who was apparently scammed out of $12 million in the swamp, wow, is back in the portal, and he's going to visit Georgia. While we get John Strickland in here for the final hour, would somebody mind giving Kirby Smart a call and let him know you can only play one quarterback, you know? It's very rare that there are two on the field at the same time, but they're attempting to sign as many quarterbacks as they have offensive linemen in Athens. So keep an eye on that. Pretty crazy. Speaking of offensive linemen, we've got ours right here on ITG.
Charleston Fitness Equipment is keeping South Carolina in shape. Clients have come from all over the Palmetto State to find that one piece of equipment that they enjoy that keeps them looking and feeling good. Whether it's a home rower, treadmill, elliptical, free weights, a home gym, or something else, Charleston Fitness Equipment keeps the mirror smiling back at you. Get in shape like the Gamecocks do. Visit charlestonfitnessequipment.com. Gamecock owned and operated and proud partners of Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
The preferred sign partner of Gamecock Athletics is Signarama Columbia, and they should be yours too. A full-service sign company that handles design, production, install, and service, Signarama Columbia has helped to bring to life the perfect vision for so many all across South Carolina. Owned and operated by proud Gamecock alumni, they can handle all types of signage, including interior and exterior, vehicle graphics, and more. Go to signarama.com and find the West Columbia location or call them at 803-407-9284. Bring your brand to life with Signarama Columbia and go Gamecocks.
Cold Joe here, and when I'm not eating average jambalaya or celebrating endless summer in Destin, I like to eat pimento cheese straight out the bucket. And the only pimento cheese I like to eat is from Nana's Porch. It's award-winning, it'll melt in your mouth, it's good on a cracker, it's good in a bowl, it's good on a piece of bread. Also, don't forget, Nana's Porch has a hell of a food truck. It's award-winning as well, and they're here for all of your catering needs. So get online, nanasports.com. It's good. Coach O signing off. Endless summer, go Tiger.
For chicken cock, we get a medium to medium plus toast. The char level, we use a number 3 level char. If you char too deep, you start burning away some of those flavor components that you just created. If you just char a barrel and you don't toast it, you're going to create some of those flavors just on a thin layer just inside the char, but not the actual depth and full extent of flavors that you're going to get if you toast it properly. All those elements, that's exactly what they do. They boil down to great flavor.
If you're in the real estate market in the Lowcountry or even in the Midlands, please contact me, JB, with Coast to Coast Realty SC. Go Gamecocks.
This break is presented by Billy G's Carolina Barbecue, the state newspaper's 2023 winner for Best Catering, Best Barbecue, and Best Food Truck. Visit BillyG'sCarolinaBarbecue.com for all of your catering needs.
Ladies and gentlemen, here it is.
I said, oh Lord Jesus, it's a fire. Ain't nobody got time for that.
Disaster comes uninformed. During and after natural disasters or accidents, there can be a heavy loss to property. Having your home or office destroyed or damaged by water, fire, smoke, or mold affects your personal and business lifestyle. Resto Pros of the Midlands is here to help. Open 24/7. Call them when you need them. 803-493-0170. Resto Pros of the Midlands. RestoProsMidlandsSC.com. Quality that is guaranteed.
Down here in the South, we don't always see eye to eye. While our taste in college football teams, or what sauce, if any, goes best on a rack of ribs, or what to mix with our Dixie vodka might be up for debate, we can all agree there's nothing better than a Southern tailgate. And like our favorite college teams, our ingredients come from small towns and big cities. They're grown in Southern soil, are crafted by Southern hands, and proudly represent the South in our backyard and beyond. So raise a glass of Dixie Southern Vodka to celebrate being made in America and raised in the South.
Welcome home. That's what the Gamecocks say, and so does the Barndo Company, where they can build your dream home starting as low as $160 per square foot. If you live in the Carolinas, Georgia, or Tennessee, their turnkey process takes just 4 to 6 months on average and can be custom designed by size and details. Make your dream a reality. Visit thebarndominiumco.com That's thebarndominiumco.com. The Barndo Company. Gamecock owned and operated.
When you're a developmental program, which all Group of Five schools are, and you lose a great player, that's going to hit you much harder with that next guy plugging in, because he's not there yet. He may be there. He's just not there right now.
I just recently reported about, the heart issue that, ultimately let the Big Ten stop, and originally decided not to play football. And we had reported out that story, kind of unearthing that it was because of heart issue, potentially with
is that myocarditis?
Myocarditis.
I still had 10 scholarship offers because Chase would go play baseball and I would get a lion's share of the reps in the spring, and they're like, who's this number 17? He's pretty good.
Listen to these interviews and more on the JC and Morgan podcast by downloading the Chief Sports app. Part of the Chief Sports Network.
All right, it is the final hour of the work week. Hootie and the Blowfish always sending us on our way here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show. This weekend, on our way to Big Gamecock Weekend, three games starting at 7 o'clock tonight at Founders Park, as the Razorbacks and the Gamecocks will tangle a lot on the line for both teams, both of them right now projected as regional hosts. And then, of course, tomorrow night, South Carolina's spring game, 7 o'clock is when they will kick it off inside of Williams Brice Stadium. And we're honored to have John Strickland. We were scheduled to have Flint, but he's just one big bleep. I'm whipped. Saying that publicly.
He's whipped.
I can't say what I'm going to do to him, but I have a plan. I'm going to destroy him. And that starts this weekend. Anyways, doesn't matter. We're not going to focus on that. We're focusing on you because here's the thing. So JC, Phil, look at this. All right. This is why we bring quality in like John Strickland. Okay. This cat's in Houston working yesterday. Responds. Yeah. I should be able to do it. I'll fly back tonight. Got to drive to Charlotte in the morning, but I should be back by noon. I'll hop on at 1. Michael's just at his house, just pantsing around doing nothing. And here we are. He's not even a part of the conversation. He's just screwing around at home. And John has flown halfway across the country to make it in time for our program.
Yeah. Got back from H-Town last night. I think I walked in the door right at 12:45 last night. And I did cancel my trip to Charlotte. I'm going to end up doing that Sunday afternoon. But it was a long week. I've been in Houston since Monday for work. That's where my office is. And I caught the Astros Braves game while I was out there, and a few meetings, and it was a good week.
How'd you like that ballpark?
I love that. I mean, we have season tickets, so we have 12 total tickets. We have some on the first, right behind the dugout on the first baseline. We got some up in club, and then we have four seats in the Insperity Club, which is the best place to sit at in the entire place. And I have to share those with some of my coworkers, so I only get those a few times. But yeah, it's a good time out there in Houston.
Dude, that's awesome. And you got to watch when the Braves came, so that's even better.
Well, you know, I grew up a Braves fan, but you know, the past 14 years I've kind of leaned towards the Astros, just because that's all the games I go to. It's where I take clients to games, and we've had season tickets forever, so it's just kind of hard not to pull for those guys when you're going to a lot of games every year.
Fair enough. Yeah, you're taking people to those games that are, you know, providing your income.
Yeah, so. Exactly.
Yeah. Exactly. I'd be an Astros fan too. Yeah. All right, John. Here we go. South Carolina. I can make one guarantee to all of you today: they will win the game tomorrow night. They will not lose this one. That's for sure. All right. So take me back to the spring game when John Strickland played, and obviously times have changed a little bit, and how we handle certain things in our programs and stuff like that. But you know, were you fired up to play the spring game? Were your teammates fired up? What was it like?
I mean, yes and no. I mean, it was kind of like, all right, spring's over. We're about to get out of school. We're going into summer workouts. Season's right around the corner. So that, you know, got you excited. You know, your parents, your siblings, your friends or whatever come out to the spring game, watch you play. So, I mean, it was fun. And you know, I like how they do a draft. I think we did a draft maybe my senior year. I think we did a draft. I can't remember. I know for the most part, it was basically, you know, they would just put the ones versus ones and twos versus twos and then mix it up with ones versus twos. So that's how it used to be. But I think my senior year, we did the draft. I mean, that was kind of fun. You know, playing alongside different guys that you maybe not have practiced with, you maybe had some second or third teamers out there playing with you versus, you know, the guys you're in practice with playing with the ones. But, I mean, it's fun. You know, it's nothing like a real game, but, no. I mean, it's a good time.
Yeah. I think they'll draft tonight. I know Lenoris is one of the captains. I'm not sure who the other captain is, but, all right. So we'll get to Lenoris in a second, John, but, who on the offensive side of the football outside of Lenore Sellers are you maybe most excited to watch play tomorrow?
I just want to watch. You know me. I'm going to be watching the offensive line. I want to see how the offensive line performs. I mean, like I told y'all last week, I really like the way this defense is shaping up, and I think we got some really good front seven players on that defense right now. So I want to see how they're able to handle it in live action in front of people. So that's what I'm looking forward to seeing is the O-line. And I think I read that you draft an O-line group. Like there's guys maybe I misread it, but I think it's what I read is they're going to draft in like groups. So you have like these five guys that have been going as the ones during the spring are the guys you can draft and so on and so forth.
Yeah, Beamer put it to where like there were going to be like if you picked one guy you might end up getting one or two more when he was talking in the presser about it.
Something like that.
Yeah.
It's like a package deal.
Yeah.
Right.
So he, because I know that obviously throughout the spring they've been playing, we talked about this last week, I think, you know, kind of musical chairs, moving guys around, seeing who fits where. This guy can play left guard, but can he play right guard? You know, doing all the things that you do in spring practice, John. But as it pertains to the game, he mentioned on Tuesday that he would like to have his offensive line comfortable with each other. Guys out there who've been standing next to guys before. Why is that important?
I mean, it just builds cohesion in a unit. I mean, it's just like, you know, I've said this before. It's just like with, you know, in your personal life with work or whatever, once you get those people together and doing the same thing over and over and over, you just get better and better and better and comfortable with each other. So that's why that's so important.
Yeah, kind of like if we had Flint here today, like we would build some cohesion, but he's decided to be a jackass and not join us on the air on Friday. Yeah. I'm going to keep burying him until he is so far under he can't come back to the surface.
Hold on.
In the backfield, I'm really excited about. There you go. Look at that.
I like it. I like it. I hope he's watching right now.
No, there's no way that he is. I know exactly what he's doing right now. Yeah. What we gotta, Phil? What are we gonna do for John? We gotta come up with like.
I'm workshopping. Creating new backgrounds for next year, so I'm trying to figure out. Yeah,
I've already done this because I do the cut ups. John, I don't know if you've looked at our Instagram account or YouTube Shorts. You became a celebrity based on last. There's like 14 vignettes of John Strickland spitting knowledge from last week's segment on our social media, all over the place. And then I cut up just your interview, and I said, this is John Strickland's insider report. And it got more views than anything I've cut up for a specific interview, not only here, but JC and Morgan. And we had a guy from the Atlanta Journal-Constitution that told us the other day that Nick Saban was coming out of retirement to coach somewhere. So viral information there. You beat every single one of them.
That's awesome. Off.
You're a guru, dude. But I mean, it's so cool because I was sitting there flipping through. I was like, what if I watched all this back to back and back? And it's just so, the delivery's so pimp and it's the info's so good. I mean, I was just blown away. I love your segments, but like when you kind of cut them up and you just have the quick, I mean, so I think it's an insider report. That's my opinion.
The insider report?
Straight from the inside. Yeah. I call it an inside. An inside Gamecock football with John Strickland.
There we go. I like that.
Strict from the inside, something like that. Or from the interior, because he was an interior offensive lineman.
Yeah.
Maybe that's it, too. Weren't you? Yeah, you were center guard. Yeah, you weren't.
So I was a guard when I came in. Then I got moved to center my redshirt freshman year, and I was Larrell Johnson's backup. And then, you know, I saw some action during the season because I did letter that year. But the Clemson game in 01, Larrell gets hurt on like the first or second drive of the game. And I play the whole entire game as a redshirt. I ain't gonna lie, I was nervous as hell. Play the entire game at center, that Clemson game in 01 that we won here at home. And that was kind of my coming out party.
Yeah, we ran it up their butt that day. I remember. Corey Jenkins had a good day, and I remember that happening too. Now that I think about it, because Laurel had moved over from the defensive line, right?
Yeah.
At some point during y'all's career, and he kind of slid it because there was somebody else that was at center before him that I don't
Scott
know,
Brown.
Scott Brown that graduated. Scott Brown,
So
there you go, man. Yeah, that was good. But yeah, I couldn't say enough. I mean, after watching it 100 times, you know, by editing it and stuff last week about that segment, I thought it was tremendous. Like,
I try. You know what? Justin King gave me some praise. What was it? It was last week because he pulled some of us players that were out of practice off outside and did some camera interviews with us and asked a bunch of questions. He's like, dang, Strick, you're pretty good at this stuff. He said, that's a great answer. That's great. I said, hey, there was a reason Coach Holtz took me to SEC Media Days, all right?
Yeah, and not Michael. Michael could never go to SEC Media Days because he's an idiot. Maybe like front and center. So front and center with John Strickland, something like that. We'll have to think about it. We'll patent it. I'm really excited about watching Juwan Howell and Oscar Attaway tomorrow.
Yeah, I am too. I mean, there's a lot of young guys. I've Bennett, Mazio. I'm ready to see what he does because a couple things I saw at practice with him. I think he's going to be somebody that you watch and slip in and. Who knows, midway through the season, he's starting at slot. I mean, he's had a good spring from everybody I've talked to. The kid's a real deal. There's a reason he was a highly praised recruit I think he's got a chance to be a really good player and keep that kind of receiver, thing we got going. We're getting receivers drafted into the NFL almost every year. I mean, I think he's one of those guys to watch out for young guys I'm talking about here.
Yeah. Speaking of receiver, the tight end position, a couple of guys who can kind of, well, at least maybe one, Josh Steinman, can kind of flex out there if he needs to and play that position. He's athletic enough to do it. And then Brady Hunt, of course, you know, they like their group of tight ends. I think Shane a couple weeks back had mentioned, you know, need some of these guys to kind of come along, you know, get off the training table and get out there and play football. But that group's pretty good. I like Brady Hunt. I keep hearing about him. You throw the ball, he catches it. What have you heard?
Yeah, he's been good. He's a big kid too. When I saw him out there, I was just like, dang, he's bigger than I thought he was. I mean, he's a big dude. I mean, he looks the part, that's for sure. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I think, you know, we talked about this months ago. Whenever we knew Simon was going to be back this year, and then you're adding Hunt into the mix too, I mean, man, that's a pretty good two tight end rotation right there. I mean, Simon at the end of the year last year, I mean, he really came on the last three or four games of the season. I'm sure you all remember that. I mean, you just started seeing him making all these catches and just breaking tackles. I mean, it would take like three or four guys to get him on the ground. So I'm really excited for the tight ends, and especially, you know, with Simon coming back, man, I'm pretty pumped up about the tight end room, because, you know, those guys are O-linemen / receivers, and I love those guys too.
I think, I'm with you, man. And I'm like Phil Schubert. Y'all remember last year before the season? It was like July and August, I guess, really mainly August. I mean, John, all I heard was, dude, this Simon kid can play. Like, he can play. And that was kind of my prediction, was Josh Simon is going to be, he's going to be a dude. And it took him, I don't know the answer. I'm asking you the question. Like, was it, I know early in the year they were maybe a little frustrated with how well he read assignments and blocked and things like that. And he was, you know, doing everything he could to get up to speed. But how much of that, his lack of production, do you think you would attribute to the fact that the offensive line just really wasn't very good?
Well, let's be real. The production that we got out of the offensive line last year because of all the injuries, I mean, it affects everybody who steps on the field on that offensive side of the ball. I mean, Spencer having the numbers he had last year behind that offensive line and that very weak run game is absolutely, I mean, that's just, it's pretty amazing, actually.
Do you think he's getting enough credit for that going into the draft, or do you think he's still being undersold?
No, he's getting credit for it. I've seen a lot of these NFL scout experts and stuff. They've spoke on it and just saying how impressive it was for him to do what he did with what he had to work with so many injuries and true freshmen on the offensive line. I mean, that's tough on a quarterback. I mean, Spence was getting hit just about every play, man. I mean, it really was. He took a beating this past year.
Yeah. I'd say. Yeah. Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you, but continue on with what you're talking about with Simon.
Yeah, but no, like, I mean, when you're throwing new guys in and then you got freshman tackles, true freshman tackles, I mean, besides you, like when it comes to run blocking and stuff, I mean, they're going to screw up too. So, you know, if one screws up, it's probably going to screw somebody else up, and you're just going to have busted plays. So, I mean, it's a waterfall effect. I mean, it affects everybody on the offense, especially what I was getting to.
I agree with you. I think back to Simon, I thought Trey Knox was solid last year. He caught some flack. I mean, that drop at Georgia, looking back on it, that's pretty brutal. What I thought the difference between the two, and this is why I'm surprised that when Knox came back from injury, he sort of resumed his old role and played, ate up the snaps. Simon was way more physical. After the catch, breaking tackles, running through contact, I thought he was a lot better blocker And that's not really blocking is not something he was known for at Western Kentucky. They ran an air raid offense. So he was basically a receiver. And Sean Elliott commented on his blocking earlier this year. So, because these guys are going to have to block now. They're not going to play. I mean, for Elliott. And so that's exciting to me because I thought Josh was physical enough last year to make a difference in the run game and the throw game. And he's got good hands and he's got good speed. And he got a better NIL deal this year, you know, and I thought that was
good. He deserved it.
Yeah. He deserves it. And I think when we talk about who's going to catch the passes now, you know, you kind of look at Josh and Brady Hunt as well. And I'll throw Michael Smith in there too. He's not here yet. But he's a stud. I think the tight ends are going to be a big part of it. And I just hope that I'm sure Dowell will do this. I mean, I hope that they're like, well, hey, maybe two tight ends is better than the, if it comes to it, than the three receivers we can put out there if we're going to throw the ball. But I'm with you guys on Josh. I thought by the end of last year, nothing against Trey Knox. I love that kid. We all love that guy, but I thought Josh was better. I thought he's better. You know, he's just playing at a better level all the way around, and so that's a positive coming back. When people talk about Carolina not having but four or five starters back, they're not counting Josh Simon, who started for a good portion.
Which
hurt.
Yeah, I think Simon was a big part of that win streak we went on at the end of the year last year. I mean, he made some big time catches and runs after the catch. I mean, just knocking people off of him and getting 10, 12 more yards. I mean, that's what you want to see out of a big physical tight end.
Yeah, his yards after contact were really impressive, even just, you know, to the naked eye. I mean, just watching him, just the common observer, it was like, man, dude, that guy, you're going to have to work to bring him down. Is there a familiarity with scheme that he should be more comfortable with playing for Loggins in a second year, John, especially when you consider tight ends have to, you know, learn blocking assignments and things like that on plays?
Yeah, you know, a lot of that holds true for a lot of positions. And, you know, I don't know if running back's really one that, you know, that it's like that, but somebody like a tight end, an offensive lineman, and a quarterback, once you get more comfortable in the scheme you're in and you know it like the back of your hand, I mean, because, you know, you had all last year to play through it. So, okay, you got it in. You're going through it this spring. You'll go through it in fall camp. And then you got that whole nother year of just learning that scheme. So it's going to help a lot of these guys out. That's why I was talking about last week. I was like, you can't get a true identity on this offense yet, all right, because you don't have all your pieces in place right now during spring. But you got a lot of these young guys, these young freshmen that played last year that are older, they're all just getting more and more comfortable with what they're, you know, what's expected of them.
Yeah.
So I think you're going to see a significant improvement. You know, you don't have Spencer Rattler this year. All right. So, but you know, the young guys got to show up and come along, and the guys who are, that are going to be playing and starting on this team this upcoming year, except for, you know, the Hunt kid and then some of these freshman receivers. And then, you know, you got one new guy running back, but he kind of already knows because Dow is running some of the similar stuff that he did at Arkansas, which he's already, you know, they've already talked about that. Yeah. So I think it's going to be good for these young guys. And I think you'll see some good improvement out of them. And, you know, once you do something for so long, it's kind of just like in the back of your head, you don't even question it. You just do it.
Yeah. I'm a huge believer in Josh Simon, huge believer in John Strickland too. It's 125. Got some breaking news here, John, from, college football. The NCAA has approved a set of rule changes and we expected this approval, but it's official now. College football will be adding a 2-minute warning starting this year at the end of both halves of play. They also are adopting helmet communications for the first time ever, mirroring what happens in the NFL. The communication will cut off at 15 seconds left on the play clock or when the ball is snapped, of course, if it's prior to the 15 second mark on the play clock. We have to get a quick timeout in Can you hold on for about 3 minutes and then when we get back?
Listen, y'all have me until 2 o'clock. So
okay, let's squeeze a quick timeout in here, and I want to get your reaction to that and how you think it may positively or negatively impact college football moving forward. The great John Strickland, front and center, no pun intended. We'll be right back.
Mike here for one of the better dining options in the capital city. You know, when I first moved there, I asked people around the radio station, where are the best wings? Well, the consensus was D's Wings. That was then. Today, they still have the best wings, but it's so much more now in their new location at 415 Meeting Street in West Columbia. Yeah, they get voted the best wings on a routine basis. Yes, they get voted the best sports bar on a routine basis, but they're not just about wings, and really, they're not just a sports bar. It is a family-run local restaurant and bar with 20 TVs and 25 beers on tap. And how about these daily specials? Every Monday night at D's, you've got 75-cent wings from 4 until closing. Tacos on Tuesday. Then on Wednesday, 18 wings and a pitcher of beer for $29. You've also got ribs and oyster bucket specials on Thursday. And no matter how big the party is, 20 or more, no problem. Just call ahead of time and they'll take terrific care of you. They'll do takeout as well. And guess what? A human will answer the phone and take the order. Billy and his staff do an outstanding job. Check out D's. 415 Meeting Street in West Columbia.
Gamecock tradition. Gamecock Traditions, South Carolina's elite retailer for anything Gamecock related. The best selection for basketball, baseball, football, tailgating, kids stuff, and everything else. If it's got the Gamecock logo, it's got to be at Gamecock Traditions. Most importantly, they ship it to your doorstep. Order online at GamecockTraditions.com, where there's always a sale. Gamecock Traditions, GamecockTraditions.com, a tradition unlike the others.
So he comes over to me and he says, listen to me. I don't want to hear one more word out of you about my refereeing today. You say one more word about my refereeing, then you're going to be thrown out of this game. And so I turned around to all my parents. I go, hey, parents, I'm not allowed to tell the ref how bad he is, so I'm going to need you to do that for me.
Oh.
He said, you
come. I'm a beggar who could use some help. I'm a seeker searching for myself. I'm a rolling stone just waiting on a friend. I'm a lover wishing on a star for another, with a broken heart to hold each other close till the end.
Nana's Porch, nanasporch.com. At Nana's Porch, they cater weddings, parties, and all kinds of special events. Their meals are served buffet style, and seconds, they're encouraged. Plus, they can bring their mobile food unit to bring on-site and serve your guests as a unique alternative for your catering needs. Inquire about rentals as well. nanasporch.com. Find them on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. 336-259-7550.
Tony Pope State Farm is your go-to agent anywhere in South Carolina, North Carolina, or Georgia for the service you deserve at the price you want. So try combining your home, life, auto, and or small business insurance today. Tony Pope State Farm has been in business for more than 30 years and can handle anything you need in the tri-state area. 843-851-2222 or visit TonyPope.com today. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
We'll be right back. All right, welcome back inside the Gamecocks, the show from the Signarama Studios. Gamecock Traditions is where you want to go. It's big Gamecock weekend. If you're making your way to town this weekend, head to Lexington or the Village at Sandhill. If you've gone to GamecockTraditions.com and it's already been delivered, well, good. You'll look great tomorrow for the spring game or tonight for the Arkansas game or whenever, whatever event it is. Maybe it's beach volleyball that you're going to attend this afternoon at 5:30. I would, by the way, highly recommend that. It's pretty good stuff. Gamecock Traditions, again, Lexington and the Village at Sandhill, they have everything that you could possibly imagine. The new camo baseball hats are in now as well. And they also have the 30-ounce and the 20-ounce. But guys like John and myself, I mean, we're 30-ounce Gamecock Yeti dudes. Why? Look over John's shoulders. That's why. You put 30 ounces of bourbon in there and just walk around like it's no big deal. Gamecock Traditions has got you covered and all the national championship gear and beyond. All right, so as we went to timeout there, I mentioned the breaking news. The two-minute warning is now a part of college football, second quarter, fourth quarter. Helmet communication. Which one do you think will impact the sport more, at least initially?
I think the helmet communication, but I'll tell you this. I like all of it. I love the two-minute warning. I think especially in a close game, it kind of gives the offense a little bit of an advantage over the defense, which I kind of like. I don't know. I've always liked it in the NFL, how they do the two-minute warning at the end of each half. Keeps you from having to waste the time out. So I don't know. That's just the way I look at it. The helmet communication, I really like. You know, you don't have to worry about somebody, excuse me, stealing your signs. You can call it straight into the field. You can actually really, I mean, here's where it's going to affect some things is you're probably going to see a little faster pace, because if you could just call a play in on a headset instead of having to look over and get a sign or whatever, I mean, that's probably 2 to 3 seconds quicker you can get a play in than the other way.
You're right. There's not a lot of up-tempo in the NFL.
There's not.
But that, like, how fast is Josh Heupel going to run his offense now?
I mean, he'll probably be, as the guy's getting tackled, the headset comes on, he's probably sitting there at the mic calling the play immediately, and they're lining up and boom.
So do you think that this is, I guess it's too early to tell, clearly, but seems a little advantageous for teams that can execute at that pace, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. I mean, it can possibly present some problems for defenses, but I don't know. I like it personally. That's just me.
Yeah, I kind of figured like some teams will be less deliberate at the line of scrimmage. Like they'll just get it in. You're going to see a lot of snaps, I think, happen prior to that 15 seconds. That way defenses don't have time to adjust.
Yeah.
That way you don't have to overthink it, especially with younger quarterbacks. Yeah, yeah. You just, yeah, boom, boom, boom.
Mm-hmm. Now, there's kind of two ways of looking at it here, because some teams, you know, they have their little signs and stuff that they would hold up, and then each position – that sign is dedicated to them to kind of tell them to play, and then the quarterback kind of calls something out. So, you know, I don't know. Maybe because it's just coming to the quarterback and he's got to call to play to everybody. But I still think it gives you maybe a 2 or 3 second advantage over signaling them plays. But I don't know. We'll just see how it works. But I dig it. I'm all about it.
Chicks dig the long ball. Speaking of that, Alabama up on number one, Texas A&M 5-2. If they hold on, it'll be their third win in four opportunities in the last 7 days against the top-ranked team in the country inside of their own ballpark. Maybe that series lost to Alabama isn't that bad after all.
Doesn't look too bad, does it?
Doesn't look too bad, does it, John?
Yeah, they put it to Arkansas last weekend.
Yeah, that's what Carolina's gonna try to do tonight. Also, a little bit of a silver lining to the two-minute timeout. That is, it will not add an extra television break. It will not add that. So they will work that into it. And so it's not like you're just tacking on another one of those, thankfully. Also, if you happen to be a hacker and you can hack into the opposing team's headset, you can maybe send the play in Spanish.
No, we need everybody on our team to learn Mandarin. All right, because that's one of the toughest languages to learn. So we'll have them all learn Mandarin, and then you don't have to worry about it.
Yeah, like you know, Billy Napier has like 400 off-field staffers. I'll bet you one of them's a hacker, and one of them is bilingual. Whenever he gets into the headset, the other cat comes on and starts speaking in some foreign language. Nobody knows what the hell's going on. All right, John, on the defensive side of the football, you mentioned this last week, and I'm glad that you were the one that said it. You've seen it with your eyes. I haven't been in the facility for spring practice. But it's hard to not get excited about this group. Number one, they're older. And they return a bunch of players who have proven their worth and their time here. But at the same time, they really did what seems it's April. We'll find out in the fall. But what seems like at this point, a nice job in the transfer portal by adding players who've played some college football, especially that front seven group. And so I'm excited to see them play tomorrow.
Yeah, I'll tell you, and the one I'm going to highlight, kind of like the Josh Simon we talked about on offense, is Bam Martin Scott, okay? Mm-hmm. He really came on at the end of the season last year, and from everything I've been told, he's carrying it on into spring ball right now. So I think he's the guy that I'm most excited about going into the fall. The way he played the last three or four games of last year, and if he's still carrying it over to the spring right now and getting even better, I really think our linebackers have a chance to be really good. I mean, we still got to get some of the guys on the two deep and three deep to kind of step up and get a little bit better. But our starting linebackers right now are shaping up to be a pretty darn good group.
Yeah, they are, and they're recruiting well, too. There's going to be some outstanding talent in town this weekend on visits from the linebacker position, including five-star Zayden Walker out of Georgia, which JC noted just a little while ago.
Yeah, you know what? I turned the TV on just to catch a little bit because I was on conference calls, but give me a little rundown on that guy, JC. What we got going on with him?
Zayden Walker.
I'm sure you've already told everybody, but just give me a quick win on this.
I didn't really break it down. He's a lot like, you know, your five-star linebacker, like Roquan Smith.
Kind of Roquan Smith.
Roquan was Roquan wasn't a five-star. He was the top 80 guy. Roquan, interesting recruitment there. Roquan committed to UCLA, and his mama went and signed a letter of intent.
Yeah.
I guess he I hope the wife's not listening, but I guess he saw some of the chicks out there that look a lot like my wife and enjoyed himself, right, at UCLA. But because it's out there. It's just big time. It's the best selection in the country. But anyway, his mama wouldn't sign it. This is during the Richt era, the end of the Richt era. They just kind of were patient. He's from Albany. I mean, that's a big that's a dog's – you know it's a dog's
right
call.
That's
yeah, right. I forgot. I'm sitting there talking about South Georgia. I forgot who I'm talking to. And time went on, and then May rolls around. Sure enough, he signs for Georgia and went on to be a hell of a linebacker. And this kid's from South Georgia, too. He's got that South Georgia nasty. He's the type of kid that Auburn usually gets, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
Auburn's made a living down there through the years if they don't go to Georgia. I know nowadays everybody's like, if they don't go to Georgia. Back, the mid-2000s, it was not uncommon for Auburn to come into South Georgia and get three of the top four players.
None of them got John Strickland.
Well, no. I told y'all my recruiting story. I was this close to going to Auburn. I mean, it's pretty close. And then once Tupperville came in, which was my senior year in high school, I just I was all about Coach Bowden when he was there. So that's why I was really hung. And a lot of my friends went to Auburn. I mean, Auburn's 2.5 hours from Baker.
Yeah,
I mean, it's
right there.
Auburn, by the way.
I mean, this is the same type of kid, like Dylan Stewart, that goes to Alabama, goes to Georgia, goes to Ohio State. Same type of guy.
Yeah.
So I mean, just he's just a linebacker instead of a D end, but you know, from when you watch Dylan Stewart guys in the spring game, nothing against the other guys, you're going to see something a little bit different about that cat. He's going to be a little bit different, and then that's who Zayden Walker is. And you know, Carolina fought a big battle to get his brother. I mean, flipped it. I've actually never seen South Carolina, the modern recruiting era, flip a player from Auburn ever.
Yeah,
I mean, most of the time it's the other way around, and that's just how it goes. But Gamecocks flipped Solomon, and now they're right there with the brother. And if they can get him, that's another big. I mean, you put him with those two linebackers they got in this class, boy. I was telling them that's probably the best I've seen the linebacking course. It's maybe Body Bags and Kenny Harney back in the day.
Well, we haven't signed a five-star linebacker since Ricardo, right?
Ricardo Hurley, yeah.
Yeah, that was the last five-star backer they got. So, and it's Ricardo. I don't want to call him a bust. He just wasn't as good as people thought. He had really hard time learning the defense. Dustin Lindsey actually took his place for his first year. Defense got significantly better. Dustin's probably about like 0.3 seconds slower, like a bunch slower than Ricardo Hurley. But Dustin knew where to go.
Oh yeah, and he was a wild man.
Kids played their butt.
You're talking about Dustin was a wild man.
They both were.
Oh yeah, yeah. No,
Jordan.
I thought you were talking about Hurley for a second. I was like, wait.
I love those guys because those two, man, they would get after it. And there was no, like, slow down or give up. And they're the same in real life. I mean, they are full go.
Yeah, I'd say so.
Yeah, I love those guys. You walk
into Rocco's or something, and one of them would have one dude held up on the – on the glass, and the other one's over here flipping tables. What's going on in here?
I mean, it was crazy because you had the Lindsey twins and the Brinkley twins back to back, and those were like two sets of twins that were just ass kicking in different ways. Craig says, did we beat Auburn for Louisville Lattimore? Yeah, Carolina's beaten Auburn for players before, but they've never flipped anybody. They flipped Solomon. I mean, he was committed, he was in their class now. He's in
they
South
flipped
Carolina's.
Solomon, Jordy flipped tables. It all worked.
Trucks. Yeah. Somebody died after the Alabama South Carolina game that year. I mean, it was. They were
worked out.
They did. Hey, I'm glad they came to South Carolina though. They made some differences. I mean, Dustin especially, it's a shame he got hurt because he would have been the next year. Remember in 07 or 06, 07, 07. Dustin had rehabbed the year before that just never made it back. 07, Brinkley got hurt in the LSU game.
Yes, he
and
did.
And Carolina had to start. They had to start some freshmen or something. They were tough. And Dustin could have stepped in and probably helped that defense a little bit.
Yeah, that Brinkley getting hurt in that LSU game, that literally kind of changed the tide of that defense that season with him going down. I think in 07 they had a really good, strong defense with him in there. And then seems like once he got hurt, it kind of just went downhill that year.
Yeah, that was tough. I'm with you, though, John. I'm actually glad their names came up. I liked both Jordy and Dusty. They were just wild. But they're good dudes. Yep. And if you were their friend, you were safe at all times.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
There's no question. Exactly right. Not a better teammate than that, knowing those guys got your back. Speaking of the back, how about the secondary? It's got such a blue collar feel to it, filled with local Gamecocks guys who are from the Palmetto State. And I know early in the season last year, I think a lot of us maybe expected to see some different things from the safeties and knowing what they had done as freshmen. But here they are now as juniors, and they're expected to produce, John.
Yeah, no, I think, like I was saying, our front seven, I think our back half, our back, our safeties, I think those guys can wind up being as good as anybody in the conference this year with the guys we got back there. And that's another two guys that I'm really excited about this year. And then, defensive back, you got some good quality players. like I mentioned last week, I know you kind of got a few guys that are still vying to lock down that one corner spot. But, man, like I said, this defense, if they can get it all together and get the right guys in place, I think we got a chance to be a pretty special defense. You know, especially on the interior with those older guys like TJ and, you know, Boogie and having a brain fart here.
Tonka,
yep. I mean, just those guys are – they've been around. They played for 3-4 years now. I mean, it's their time to shine. I mean, I think this has got a chance to be a really good interior defensive line for us.
Yeah, I agree with that. This is a nuts and bolts question. John, it's often said in any sport, they can't win without talent. How much talent do you think they have on defense?
I think we have a good bit of talent. I mean, if you look at all the guys that are starting for us, you go back and look at them from high school. I mean, the majority of them are pretty high recruits. I mean, so now it's time for them to start living up to that, you know, 4-star potential that we got. And then you throw in the young guy, Dylan Stewart. When I watched him at practice last week, like JC was saying, you're going to see a little bit something different. The dude's different, okay? He's a different dude. I watched him on a few pass rushing plays when I was out of practice last week, and he's got that giddy up, get off, and he can come flying around the edge. I mean, I'm super excited about it. You can just tell this is why he's a 5-star recruit, just because of his pure athleticism. He his God-given athleticism he was given. I mean, he's a dude for sure.
Can you describe for us the situation that he's in, knowing that there are older and talented guys at his position via the transfer portal, of course, and then young guys like Desmond Umiazulu, who I'm very excited to see as well.
Yeah, me too.
Who played last year. But, like, I remember when Clowney came in, John, and while we were all, as, you know, fans and viewers of the program, national media, everybody couldn't wait to watch him play, and you knew it was inevitable that he would end up being the star of the show, just like he was. But the coaching staff also knew, led by your friend Brad Lawing, he rest in peace, that they didn't need Jadeveon Clowney to come in and be the star as a freshman. Like, they didn't need him to come in and carry that weight. They had players.
Oh yeah, they had dudes on that 2010 team at the D line. That's a fact,
right?
Bunch of NFL vets entire D line.
Exactly, they all went to the league. Every friggin' one of them.
Yeah.
So, but this kid, and it's not fair, and I don't mean this that way. Like, I'm not necessarily comparing this group to that group. Again, we haven't seen this group, and that group is the most elite I've ever seen here at that position overall. But what is it like for a freshman like that in your mind? And you've seen in practice, you've been with these players when you played at South Carolina, guys who come in and they feel like they have to shoulder the load. Like, that's a lot on a young kid. This kid doesn't have to do that. He can, I don't want to say take his time, but like, when his time is right, it'll be right, instead of kind of being thrown into the fire and expecting to produce in order for this defense to play well.
Right, right. Well, I'll tell you, I've never been in his shoes. I was a measly 3-star recruit, you know, so not a top 15 guy in the country, you know. But, no, I mean, I'm sure the coaches take care of this, but I'm sure he feels some kind of pressure being at the status he was at and being the top recruit in this past class. I mean, of course he's going to feel like there's some weight on his shoulders that he has to go out and perform and do something. But – the best advice to give the kid is just go play free, go play ball. Don't worry about all that other stuff. And when you do that, all the rest of it will take care of itself. I mean, I think Clowney, Clowney's such a low-key guy, laid-back guy. I don't think he didn't put that weight on his shoulders. You see the way he plays a freshman. You know, he'd come off the bench. How about that Georgia game in 2010? All the plays he made that game as a freshman, all right? Mm-hmm. So – I mean, you hope that's what you get out of Stewart as well, but he shouldn't put the pressure on himself. He just needs to go have fun, enjoy your time, and the rest of it will take care of itself, especially with how athletic and big this guy is.
We'll wrap it up with this. John, the last time that Sean Elliott, or not the last time, but one of the last memories I have of Sean Elliott running out of that tunnel was in 2015 after Coach Spurrier had resigned, and he ran out carrying his visor, as we all remember. He was one out of there, and he was in a hurry to get to the sideline. Sean ran with a purpose. I'm sure y'all crossed paths last week at some point in time. You know, Sean, he is a Gamecock and a South Carolinian through and through. I'm really excited for him, and I'm really excited for Summer and for his kids to be able to walk into Williams Brice Stadium tomorrow night and see Dad 10 minutes from home.
Yeah, you know he's pumped up about it. Yeah, I went up to him after practice, just told him, hey, Coach, good to see you. Glad you're back. Da, 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 da. Just small chat real quick. So haven't had a chance to, like, really dive in and talk to him. But, I mean, if you just watch some of his interviews and what he said to the media, I mean, you can tell. I mean, the grin on his face is, like, up here, you know. He is super pumped to be back here. And, you know, he loves this place. But it's even better for, you know, his wife and his kids to have Dad at home every day instead of, you know, over in Atlanta and having to drive 3 hours back and forth all the time. So, you know, he's going to be fired up. You just – everybody look for him out there in pregame and see what he's up to. He's going to be throwing some
elbows. If there's anybody that can make sure that those
– Oh, yeah.
That's right.
He'll have them ready to go. He'll have them ready.
Yeah. If these guys are sleepwalking into a spring game tomorrow night, he'll wake them up. That's for sure. I'm really, really excited for that. Is it okay for fans that are going to be in Gamecock Park to swing by the Letterman's tailgate just to say hello to folks like yourself tomorrow? I'm sure you'll be there for a little bit at least, won't you?
Yeah, I'm going to go hang out. I'm going to walk around and make the rounds. Definitely come over to Flint's for a little bit. But, yeah, I mean, they can all stop by. And then you got the third annual Bourbon Bash tonight at CB18. I think that money is going towards NIL, if I'm not mistaken.
I'll be there.
Well, JC, I was just going to ask you, make sure you're coming to hang out, right?
I am. My first bourbon bash. It's only the second bourbon bash, but I know the Gamecock Bourbon guy on Twitter. I'm a big fan of his. So I hope there's beer there, though, because I don't drink bourbon.
Oh, come on, man.
Hey, you don't want me to drink bourbon. So, I'll be there. I'm looking forward to seeing you guys. I really am. It sounds like it'll be a great time.
Yeah, it'll be fun. So getting to catch up with some old former teammates tonight, and should be a good fun weekend. Hopefully, the baseball team can pull an upset this weekend, and hopefully take at least 2 out of 3. That would just be the cherry on top for the weekend.
Oh, yeah, they're gonna give it a crack tonight. There's no doubt. Give Coach Tannehill a big hug from us here at ITG, and I'm sure. I guess he'll be out there. I would imagine.
He'll be there.
I don't think he's gonna miss that one.
John,
I will give you a shout on the way in tomorrow morning, and our schedule won't be really figured out until after they announce what they're going to do with this series with weather coming in Sunday. So they'll announce that after 5 o'clock today. So, but somehow. We'll link up tomorrow at Williams Brice Stadium. Look forward to seeing you. Thanks for all you do, and pull them through tomorrow night. Gonna need this big. This is a big one here.
Oh yeah, huge football game tomorrow night, right?
That's right.
I'm kidding, guys. I'm kidding. Come on, come on.
But can't miss and can't lose.
We'll be over at our condo by the stadium, and we'll swing by Big Fun's condo.
Big Fun.
Big Fun Flint. Oh,
they don't know. Yeah, they don't know Michael's dad's nickname.
Yeah, Michael Flint's dad's nickname is Big Fun. He used to be a lot of fun.
Yeah. Big, yeah.
He's kind of chilled though now that he's older. But
oh yeah, okay. Oh yeah, no doubt.
That's great.
Yep, times were good.
Times were good.
Now you walk in after the game, he's laid up in a recliner with a glass of wine. When you assholes gonna get out of here?
Yep.
Damn, man.
Yep. Oh man, this is no lie. Back in after I got done playing, it was basically probably 2008 to 2013 before everybody started getting married and having kids and all that. We used to party over there till 3:30, 4 o'clock in the morning after home games, and you know, I'm sure they hated us all over there.
That's why he leaves sometimes now after games, you know, and goes home. I asked him last season. He's like, I'm getting out of here. Y'all you keep Mike out of trouble. I was like, okay. I said, where are you going? I'm going home. I was like, you're driving home? Hell no. I'm making David drive me home.
Yeah, that's the way to do it.
Man, you get old, turn the condo over to Charlotte.
Yeah,
he just enjoys it now.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
All right, John. Thanks, man. Can't wait to see you.
All right. I'll see you later, JC, and the rest of y'all this weekend.
Hey, keep JC out of trouble too. I'm planning to see him tomorrow.
We'll see how it goes.
You don't ever know. Man.
That should be a short walk, or are you staying in a different place, JC?
I am actually in a different. Am I muted? No, I'm not. I'm actually in West Columbia, so I'll be Ubering it.
Oh, yeah. That's Uber can handle that.
Yeah,
yeah. Uber's one call away. You'll be fine.
That's right. It'll be good.
Yeah.
Thanks, dude.
Awesome. Right, thanks, guys. John.
Mm-hmm. All right. See y'all.
John Strickland. He's the man. There is the. In the front of Gamecock Park tomorrow, the Letterman's Association will have it's private just for Carolina football players. But if you walk by, they're always willing to sign autographs and stuff like that. So if anybody's going to be out there, Brewer will be there. Bunch of folks.
Nice. Right.
Did we miss anything today?
No.
I don't think so. I do know this. We didn't get to this. Carolina basketball. Right now is right in the thick of it in the transfer portal, and over the next few days, I'd say keep a pretty close eye on it. Some good stuff could be coming your way.
Coach Paris is on a heater.
He is on a heater. There's no doubt about that. Speaking of heaters, from 5-2 to 6-5, A&M with a grand slam in the fifth inning to take the lead. Game one. Heritage being played as well. So we got bunch of good stuff on deck. For all of you headed to the spring game and baseball games and everything in between at Big Gamecock Weekend, have a blast. That's what this weekend's for. Hope your kids enjoy it. Thanks to John Strickland, and, of course, thanks to Stuart Lake for joining us back in hour number one to preview this top 20 matchup between the Razorbacks and the Gamecocks, and to all of our guests this week. Next week, we'll have a bunch of football guests in here, and Daniel Kelly will be here on the day of the draft. Brad Crawford will be in next week. Strick will be back, and we've got a couple others in addition to some major bases. It's going to be a very guest driven week around here.
A lot of football talk, and then hopefully some more basketball recruiting. I don't think we're like you're right. We're not done talking about that yet.
No. They're just getting started. Those of you that we will see on Monday, we'll see you Monday. Shotgun start at 9 o'clock out at Fort Jackson as part of the TBS golf tournament. For Phil, yeah. Do what, JC?
No, I didn't say anything.
Oh, okay. For this Phil and JC.
Microphone, man.
I'm JB. We'll see you Monday right here on ITG.